We are recording now. To get that. So those of you who don't know why we're recording just because. It's not just because. We are posting it up on a YouTube channel that we're in the process of changing to make it a little bit easier to access. And you will be allowed to look back and review a class if you want to do that. Or if you have to leave early or miss a class, I can give you an assignment that's relating to something we talked about in class. So that's the purpose of it. And so where possible, we capture. Now, I've forgotten a few to record them, and a couple of them I ran out of space in the middle of a recording and didn't have capture the whole thing. So it's not perfect. It's subject to a little bit of variation. The class is better anyway. You get interaction and so forth in class, so do try always to be here. If you can, but you're running businesses, and as such, there are times, there are things that happen, and just communicate, let us know. Brad's one of our students that texted me a few minutes ago, and Maddie and I laughed about his text. He told me why he's going to be late, but you don't have to always do that. It was related to his job, but it's cool if you do. I'm always interested, and I usually don't laugh at your texts, so or share them with other people. They're private, but please do communicate. Let us know what's going on, and as long as I have an idea, I'll make sure that we get you covered. So that if we've got something that I for sure want you to get, in the way of a handout or an experience or something like that, then we will cover that. We have several housekeeping kinds of things to talk about tonight that we will try to cover as quick a time as we can. Things like what's my name, what's your name, what's my cell number so I can receive your texts. Things like that, introduce each other a little bit, establish some ground rules for the class. Learn a lot, but we need to establish them. And some of them are simple, like you don't have to shut your phones off in this class. Some college classes you do. In this one, I like you to Google stuff every now and then. It keeps me honest, and you can check my facts and add to the class. So you're welcome to do that. What I don't want you doing is engaging in a long text string in your private life while you're in class. That's not respectful to the rest of the students, so please don't do that. Never had a problem with that. I'm just putting it out there so that y'all know. If you've got somebody you love in labor and they're at the hospital, for sure answer your phone. Just don't disturb the rest of us. Step out of the class and take a call if you need to do that. We will have a break during class. We will try to call the break. We need to sign that too, don't we? We need to sign somebody to let us know when break time is. And Larry, you were close. That was a seat. That's right where I'm looking, right on the way to the clock. So if you're going like this or if you're asleep, then I know that I've missed break time.
So right? If I don't wave, we just go right
in. But if I miss it, everybody let Larry know. He's going to let me know when it's break time, if I miss break time. And occasionally we move break by a few minutes one way or the other based on what we're talking about. We'll have more ground rules as I think of them. We are informal in this class in the sense that you all have things to add. Much of the value of the class is learning from each other, not from me. And so as such, we want to establish quickly the value of who else is in the room here. I love it when I discover where people's talents are. And I have the assumption that everybody here tonight has an area, and some of you have enormous areas where you are way more advanced than I am, and you have more knowledge that I don't have. And I want us to draw that out. I want to learn from you, and I want us all to share the knowledge. We got experts in the room on stuff. And so if we can mine that and share it with each other, we're all better off for it, right? So we're going to try to take advantage of that and do that. In order for us to take advantage of that, you have to be willing to say something out loud. So we're going to practice a few things. We will have a few assignments where you will make a presentation. You may make it from your seat. You may make it from up here. As we make assignments, we'll decide, and I'll let you know what they are. And those presentations, if you want to call them that official, I will call them that, are designed for a couple purposes. Not to freak you out, but our life is full of presentations. If you've got a significant other in your life, you've already made one, you know, that third weekend in October, you're going to go on deer hunt. You know, you've made a presentation. You've told somebody you're not going to be home that weekend. And you maybe invite them to go with you. Maybe you don't. Maybe you discuss, but you influence someone else, right? That's a presentation. And in work, we make presentations all the time, and most of our most important presentations aren't formal. They're elevator pitches. They're presentations that are made casually in the hallway. That meeting after the meeting, if you don't think that happens, start watching next time you're invited to a meeting and look for the meeting after the meeting. The people will leave, and a couple of them will get back together. That's the real meeting. That's where influence happens. That's where stuff occurs that we can participate in strategically if we're watching for it, and we want to use that as an opportunity to get an agenda across. We're not trying just to get our way. We're trying to make things better. And as I see things, my way is better, right? But I need to present it to you in such a way that, because maybe it isn't. Maybe it's just my perspective, and maybe I need that interaction. We need to have something that I will call vigorous debate. Now, vigorous debate is not an argument. It can become that. And that's a problem. That's a dysfunctional company. And we've all seen them, or maybe we've even worked in them. And hopefully we haven't been to dysfunction. We have the same thing in relationships at home. Disagreement is required for innovation. A difference of opinion is all disagreement is. And so your perspective versus my perspective, they aren't the same. I stand in a different point, at a different age, with different experience than any of you have. And so I don't know your perspective and you don't know mine. But they are different. And we will need to share those if we're going to advance the cause, right? If we're going to discover a pool of shared knowledge, the crucial conversations people call that pool of shared knowledge. I know stuff that you don't know, and you know stuff that I don't know. We need to put it in the pool together between us and stir it up and look at what's great value there. Some of the things that I put in there are of value, some of the things you put in there are of value, and we need to have that without the conversation going silent or violent, right? Where I shut down and stop talking, and then there's no influence that occurs, right? There's no innovation that occurs. There's no advancement that occurs. Our company doesn't get any better. I just shut down. Or, worse, they start calling you names or something. That's violent, right? An attack, an emotional attack, or I raise my voice. I get intense. Those are violent things, and that causes other people sometimes to either return the favor in a real shouting match, escalated shouting match, and that's not productive for business ever, or they shut down. And that's not going to get us where we want to get either. So we practice a little bit of stuff here in this class, just making a presentation, which is just putting our thoughts together to try to influence and say how we would do that. And we'll do that informally, without a grade, but the camera will be on, so that later on, if you want to get a copy of what you said, we can make that happen. We haven't done much of that to this point, but we can make that happen. I just figured out how to do it. Everybody made final presentations of the module before this one, and I've got that figured out so that I can give privately to each person the video footage of them making their presentation, which is going to be of value. You look at it, and some of you will look at it and you'll critique yourself. Some of you will just want to show your kids. Say, look at this. This is cool. This is how cool your dad is. That's what he did at work and at school. And speaking of school, in case those of you that are new haven't registered this quite yet, you're in college for real. This is the real thing. This isn't a weekend ballroom dancing course. This is a college course that's the real deal. And if you aren't proud of yourself for doing that, you ought to be. So reevaluate that, think about that a little bit, and share that with the people you care about. You're going to college. And I think that's one of life's cool events. When we're able to invest in ourselves and our future to do something like this. And so this is, I think, as good as it gets in Utah and maybe some classes worldwide. We will model, in fact, we're going to see how Harvard conducts a class like this tonight. We're going to watch what case histories do. We're going to have a number of case histories that we're going to be using, and I want to explain to you, I'm modeling out of what I've learned in that setting. I did not graduate from Harvard, but I've gone to courses there, and their teaching style is something that they teach. They teach the teaching style, they teach the way to teach to those of us that want to learn that. And so we're going to implement some of that here in this class, and I'll let you come along for the ride with me on that as we go through that together. We'll have some other ground rules that we will think about. The informality part is something that I want to, which means that you interrupt me at any time. That is fine. We can do two things at once. Guys aren't really good at multitasking, by the fact that we like to claim that we are. We're not. Don't ever underestimate a lady's ability to multitask. Ever. Don't ever. Just that's a life principle that you need to know. There are skills there, and I don't know how to learn them myself. But we're going to start with a little bit of multitasking right now. While we are doing introductions and talking, and I want to hear a little bit from Maddie, I'm going to pass a big stack of paper around. In this stack of paper, I have the leadership principles, the value statement, a mission for 96 different companies. And it's on two pages, so you have to take two companies. This one's Tesla and SpaceX, and on the back is Intuit, which is QuickBooks. Here's Visa, Trader Joe's, Toyota, Zappos, IKEA, Uber. You know, they're just companies that you know the names of, and this is how they teach their value statements and what matters to them from a leadership point of view. I'm going to pass this around. I'm going to start this stack of papers in the back corner with Jake. Flip through them. Don't look at all 96 of them and read them. Grab a company, grab one that you want, and it'll have two sides to it. And then pass the stack on to the next person, and I want them all to wind up down here. So when they get down here, I'll know that everybody has one sheet of paper with two companies on it. Okay? That's multitasking. While we talk, you can flip and shuffle. Okay? That we'll see how that does. And while we start that, Maddie, this is Maddie. She is behind all of our cool programs, and I don't know how many of you have got going right now, but an enormous number of stuff. And if any company needs special training, and it's not something we offer a degree or a program or a full-blown course in, talk to Maddie, because her job is to do what she tells you. We're here to serve companies, and if your company needs some training, she is the person who can hook that up.
Thank you, Steve. So, like you said, my name is Maddie Clark. I am the coordinator over all the professional development we do here on campus. excuse me. And we have set classes that are consistently happening, everything from QuickBooks to Class B CDL, very diverse. I don't have a lot of restrictions because I am not over the accredited programs here on campus. So if you work with a business or run a business and you ever see that there are some pieces missing, maybe you need some additional HR training, maybe you need some finance training, maybe you need QuickBooks or Excel, anything like that, we can actually custom build classes for you. Or you're welcome to enroll in classes that we already have. In regards to this class, this is one little piece. Our human resources is a single class offered through professional development, but it's a single class as a part of a larger program here on campus called strategic management. If you take this class and you decide that you love it and you'd like to be enrolled in our full program and take all four classes, you can start with this class, take the next two, and then we'll put you into our next cohort for the beginning class that you missed, which is performance leadership. But we would love if you are interested in continuing your education, hopping into that full program. And when you finish that, you get a certification from Dixie Tech, which is accredited through the state. So anytime you guys need any sort of additional training, we're working closely with Wilding Wallbeds. A lot of their workers are here tonight. We have gone in and done some specific training for their needs, and we can do that for any companies. I also work closely with Marie Bocut, who is over Custom Fit. Custom Fit is money to give to businesses. So if you work for a business that is interested in getting their employees or staff trained in anything, Custom Fit can reimburse 40% of those training costs. So if a business paid for you to be here tonight, reach out to me and and we can actually get 40% of that cost reimbursed to you. So it's good to have you here. And just so you know, Steve Carwell is the ultimate human. I cannot believe he works here as an adjunct at Dixie Tech, because when you hear about what he's done with his life, it is phenomenal. I'm always like, how do we get these instructors here who build these incredible things in industry, and then they're like, I'm going to go teach at Dixie Tech. So we have the quality of quality here in instructors. All right. Have a good class.
Thank you, Maddie.
Yep.
Do they know how to get a hold of you? Do you have cards and stuff?
I don't have any cards with me, but I should have. Yeah,
I'll remember down here if anybody needs to.
I actually have a marker in my pocket.
Oh, you got a marker in?
Well, I've been setting up classes.
That is awesome. All right, we have a little bit of orientation that's a requirement, and a requirement of really any public gathering. We ought to know what to do if something bad happens. And unfortunately, bad stuff does happen. I went to Chicago this weekend, and we all know why the flags are half-mast. It's because of another senseless shooting in America. This one was in Highland Park, Illinois, a well-to-do north suburb of Chicago. It's not a neighborhood you'd expect. It's not, you know, straight out of Compton or something where that you would go, I see that. Highland Park's not an area like that. It's kind of like an area that you think of in, you know, Kayenta or something in St. George. You know, it's like, how could there be a shooting there? But there was. And it's just another in a long list of things. So one of the things we will touch on in our orientation tonight is we will touch on a shooter. What happens if there's somebody that comes on campus that is going crazy? Those of you that have taken other courses have heard this part before, and we have been asked to repeat it every time we start the module, so that we've got maximum number of people on campus that are ready, at least in the thought process. So a couple things that don't have anything to do with an active shooter on campus. If we catch something on fire, sometimes we do experiments and things sometimes go wrong and we catch stuff on fire. If there's a fire in this building or any of the buildings on campus, your job is not to put it out. Call 911 if you can, but get out. And if you can help me get out, do that, but don't risk yourself in the process of trying to drag me out. Get out of the building, get to safety, make sure somebody calls 911 if possible, but it is not our job or our training to fight a fire. The campus has determined that's risky, and they're right. Bad stuff happens in fires. Hopefully this building is designed so it won't much catch on fire. And if we do something stupid ourselves and have a little fire, hopefully we'll have the means to put it out without calling the fire department, because I never like it when I have to call the fire department because I didn't have the adequate stuff to distinguish whatever it was that I started on fire. We need to know what to do if somebody has a medical issue. The most likely medical issue is me with a heart attack. Just because of age and weight, I'm the likely candidate. I hope that doesn't happen. But if I go down, I hope there's people with CPR in the room that you will do two or three things. First of all, somebody try to get me jump started. Second, somebody call 911. Third, somebody go down the hallway on this floor, turn right, and on the left-hand side, you'll see a red sign that says AED. Which stands for battery charger. Get it. It's got instructions on it. You don't need to know how to run it. When you open it up, it will talk to you. And you will hook me up and hopefully jumpstart me back. Okay? And that goes for anybody else. We have had people in this building go down, and we have used the AEDs in this building. So it's not something that's far away, and we don't think would ever happen. I hope it does not happen, but it already has in this building. I had a student in one of my operations management classes stand up, pick up his briefcase up, and hit his head on that beam that's going in. It was not this room, it was a room like it that had beams in it like that. Hit his head in the beam. It caused a stroke, and he lost his career. He was a licensed CDL truck driver. and he lost his CDL because of the medical injury that happened in the classroom. He went down hard. We had we teach paramedics and EMTs in this building as well. So fortunately, we found some that were on duty, and they bridged the gap to keep him from dying. It was a serious wound, the blood on the brain, just from the beam, standing up on the beam in the classroom. So we don't think things will happen, and I always hope that they won't, but if they do, let's be good citizens as best we can. Just for yucks and grins, how many have an active CPR ticket? A couple of you are kind of not admitting it. Okay. All right. So that's cool. We got a couple of people in the room that can help teach the rest of us. So if somebody is a CPR or somebody gets that certification and we have a medical emergency, please be assertive. Use your skills and talent and take charge. And I have my CPR. I will help if I'm not the one that's down. And so that's kind of a ground rule here. You can come and go. You don't have to wait till formal breaks. If I've gone too long or you drank too much coffee, there's a men's room and a ladies' room outside this room in both directions. The larger one is towards the main elevator in the middle of the lobby area. Downstairs, there's upstairs restrooms as well. There's a one-seater, male and female, to the left. And so at break time, it's not a wise thing to go left because somebody's going to beat you unless you're first in line. But the larger restrooms are more accommodating there. We have a emergency exit that is of interest. If you go out this room, make the corner to the main hallway, and bear, you can go either direction and find an exit. The closest one is to go left. There's a red fire extinguisher at waist level. That's the door. It's a fire alarm. You can pull a fire alarm. And if there's fire, pull the alarm on your way out. That's at the top of an exit stairs. There are other exit stairs that are located that direction in the building. I would recommend on break that you explore the floor a little bit and find out where other manual ways are that are out, because if we've got most emergencies, the elevators are not advisable to use. And some of us have been stranded on the elevators too, so they're fairly new, but the building's new, but they're not 100%. Let's see if I'm missing anything else in the way of critical. Oh, tests, exams, quizzes, finals, that kind of stuff. Everybody's always apprehensive about that. Don't be. We will have some exams, they will be written. Everything that I do in this class will be open book, and it will be take home, which means that you can, if we have a quiz or an exam, a midterm or a final that you need to do, I will give it to you, you will take it home, and you'll bring it back when you've completed it. You can talk to other people, you can look at your book, you can Google, you can do what you need to do. They're not still all that easy sometimes when you can do that. But don't freak out that you have to memorize anything. Well, let me explain to you why. I don't think that, well, the amount of knowledge in this world is gaining fast, right? It's doubling. And right now, the rate they're saying the human knowledge base is doubling about every 10 hours. But think about that for a minute. That's beyond my imagination. And I remember when they said it doubled every few years, and I didn't think that was probably true. And I don't think Sir Isaac Newton had to worry about that. Back in his day, he was just writing stuff down that was cool. Yes, sir. Are you going to be down there for what? Or are you just here for that?
2 minutes.
I'll call you at 8:30.
I'll see if I can swing back by.
Okay.
Before I go pick my boy up.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. Thanks. Sorry for the interruption. He is OSHA in Southern Utah. He can interrupt anybody anytime, pretty much.
Mm-hmm.
That's the way they like to do things. kind of lost my train of thought where I was at. So, final exams. Why? I don't think that we can rely on our memories. I think that we have to rely on where is it that we find information at. And I use the example that my doctor, you know, got out of med school maybe 20 years ago, and the medicines that he memorized aren't the ones that I want him to prescribe today. You know, some of them are obsolete. Some of them are bad medicines, and they've been proven to be they cause cancer and whatnot. And so we've come up with better stuff. And you know, I want the doctor not to go based on what he memorized. I want him to use the current best stuff. So look it up, Google it. I'm okay with that. Find out what the right answer is. Now, everything that you Google isn't true. Isn't that correct? So one of the things that we learn by having an open book exam is you have to discern about what's right and what's wrong. I have looked up, and you have too, YouTube videos of guys fixing stuff on your car or telling you how to wind a motor or do something, and they're all sure about what they're doing, but they're giving you wrong information. You know enough to know they're wrong. You look at that and go, I hope somebody doesn't follow that. That's not safe, or it's wired backwards, or something's wrong with that. I mean, you've pointed out a few to me that you found that were just flat out wrong. And some of those come from manufacturers and stuff. They get it wrong too. So for us to discern what is right and what is wrong, that's what part of life is. And so we'll be doing that when you have an exam. So don't freak out about tests and exams. There will be a couple of assignments as well. They will be clearly spelled out. They won't be surprises, and you will be able to achieve something to be proud of it as you do that. So, like I said, I probably have some more ground rules that I want to talk about. But before we go through active shooter, I want to watch a video that some of you have seen, and I hope that will, by seeing it again. I had another one that our security team said, no, stay with the one you're using because we want to reinforce it. Because most of us don't have enough training on what to do in an emergency where there's an active shooter. And so we're going to rely on our training. So if we burn some training in, we want it to be consistent. And so we will do that. But before that, I'd like a little bit of an introduction from everybody that's here. This will be your first experience of addressing the group. You'll find out that nobody says anything, nobody bites, nobody, I won't say nobody laughs. Sometimes people laugh, okay, but probably not at you. It's probably because my fly's open or something, and they just noticed it and told everybody. And so we'll introduce. I want you to think of and share with us what was the lowest paid job you ever had. And it probably goes back, hopefully, to when you were younger, and not currently doing it. And since I'm older than you, my pay, say how much it was. Say what you worked for. And then tell me, a couple of things that were really cool about that job, in spite of it being bad pay, or what we look at maybe as, you know, inexperienced pay or frontline. We've all done those jobs, and I want to hear about one or two. So I want to know your name. I want to know what you're doing now, if you're a full-time student or if you're employed somewhere, and kind of what you do. What was the lowest paid job you ever had? What was a good thing about that? And that will be all we will talk about for today. And we will go around the room in order so you can kind of know what order it will be. And I will start with Luke up here, and we'll move this direction, and then we'll go that direction, and we'll end with Jake up there. Okay, so.
My name's Luke Emack. I'm from St. George. I run my own company. I work at Dairy Farmers America. And I've been an electrician for basically ever. And my lowest paid job was when I started that. It was $7 an hour. And yeah, it was awesome. I got paid about $800 a month. And it was great. We worked a lot of hours back then. There was like three of us on. I was the smallest one. I was 2 foot nothing, and they would throw me around there all the time, and he just thought I was the greatest. But I learned a lot, not electrical wise, obviously, but I learned a lot working. It was when I first started. I was 16, and it's been good from there. So
perfect. Thank you.
I'm Joel Sanders, and I work for S&S Steel Fabrication. It's actually a family business, and I've worked there almost 30 years. And I've done their payroll, and then we just recently acquired St. George Steel also. So we doubled our workforce, and so I'm doing their payroll and a lot of their human resource stuff also. And I've never had formal training, ever. So I just thought it would be a good idea to come here and do this. And my lowest paying job was probably Taco Time, fast food. I think I made like $3.35 an hour. I think that was minimum wage back then. Mm-hmm. And I think everybody in the world should have to work fast food. It is a hard job. Yeah. You have to learn to deal good with other people and work fast, and you can't drop the ball. At least that's how it was when we had good customer service back in the day.
I remember that.
Yeah.
Thank you, Joel. Thank you.
Yeah.
Eli.
My name is Eli Ringo. I actually also work at S&S Steel as a fabricator, fitter, welder, machine operator. Do it all pretty much. My lowest paying job was my first job up in Springdale as a night auditor at a hotel. It wasn't too bad. Didn't have to deal with many people, but some interesting people come in at 2 a.m. to a hotel. Just pretty
Some stories there, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah.
What was good about it? The interesting people?
Yeah. That was by far the best part was the stories gained from it. Everything else is special.
Okay. Next.
I'm Josie Blackmore. My most paying job was when I was housekeeping at my first hotel for $10.25 an hour. I learned a lot of responsibility working there, and I was 14 at the time, training 50-year-old women. It was a good opportunity for me to be able to reach out of my comfort zone and take on responsibility at a young age.
A lot of lessons to learn there. When you're training anybody that's not a match for us, you know, a friend that we hang out with, whether it's a gender, age difference, background difference, all that is a training challenge, and you're learning a lot there.
Sorry, I'm Larry. I work for Wild and Ball Beds as the assistant manager. My lowest paying job was at Wendy's many, many years ago, back when the Dead Sea was just sick. I guess the thing about it is that was the first time I didn't work for family and got to interact with other people and learn to work as a team.
Okay, thank you.
My name is Andrew. I work for Wilding Wall Beds as the production manager. My first job was at Curtis Bakery. Making $4.75 an hour. Took the job so I could save money to buy a PlayStation. Was after school for 2 hours a night, and the only good thing about that job was the free donuts. Yeah.
Everything else was downhill, huh?
Yep.
Alright. Denver?
So my name is Denver. I'm the general manager at Papa John's and tiny part owner. It was my first job. I worked at a barbecue joint back in Kansas City, and I was a dishwasher. And I became a fry cook too, and I kind of learned how to interact and talk with people, I guess, and how to talk with workers and coworkers, especially during a hard rush whenever it was slammed, and how to communicate with each other better, and also learn how to, I mean, especially how to talk with your coworkers too. But, so I learned.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yep.
My name is Brennan. My lowest paying job was at $8 an hour. I worked at a flower shop for my grandma. And I'd say the best part about that job was I got to meet a lot of people, had a lot of money behind them, learned some things about running business, big businesses, and that's really the only good thing about it. I just know the boxes and things.
What you doing now?
I work at Factory Power Sports and look over events.
Nice. Great, thanks. We'll hear a few around here. Up in the classroom, everybody looks when it's over here. Somebody wind one up.
I'm Callie. My lowest paying job was probably Domino's Pizza. I was making like $7.25 or $7.50 an hour. But the good thing was I was 14, so it was okay because I was 14. And we got free pizza all the time when we messed up orders.
Huh. Sound familiar?
Yeah.
The guy's messing up on pizza on purpose. On occasion.
Now I'm at Balance of Nature. I am looking for a new job.
Okay. Well, there's people in here that might be interested. I see a bunch of heads nodding already, so you might be in a good place depending on what you're looking for.
My name's Alyssa. My lowest paying job was cleaning stalls at a barn for $10 an hour. I met a lot of people. I learned a lot of responsibilities and stuff, but definitely sucked. I now work for a local shaner here, and he owns a pretty big business I'm trying to pick his brain on, but I met a lot of people.
Well, and the rodeo world's a completely different world, isn't it?
Yes,
it's
very
it's
different.
It's probably we can learn a lot. I think some people will think it's cool.
Right? I'm Eric. My lowest paying job was in Apple Auto Parts. It was $8 an hour, and the cool thing about that job was driving a forklift and getting on a delivery truck being a teenager.
Mm.
And now I work at Stuart Awning, and I do patio covers, build outdoor kitchens, and currently been there for about 6 years, and it's going good.
Thank you.
Best for last, I guess.
My
name is Jake. I work for Wilding Wall Beds, custom service manager over there. My lowest paying job is a dishwasher at a local restaurant in Cedar. Jay Beeson has a dishwasher. Best thing about that, I guess, is I learned the value of a clean plate.
Yeah, very important.
Yeah.
That's about it. I've been there for 6 months.
Well, I appreciate each one of you addressing the room. That was a frightful experience for some, maybe for all of us a little bit. None of us like to really be put on the spot. You know, every now and then there's a human being that thrives on that, but most human beings have this little twinge of butterflies inside and something that, you know, makes us a little bit, makes it hard. And we have physiological responses from that. We'll talk about some of those later, but we have to understand that they're real, they're normal, and we're not the only people that has them. And in spite of that, we can still win. We can still get our point across. We can still communicate. And bad things don't always happen. I mean, sometimes we choke. But when you choke, usually that's not the end of the world. We regroup, put it back together, apologize, and do whatever it is needs to be done. And everything's fine. And in some cases, when we choke, it actually is better, because people see the human side of us, the humanity in us. And that establishes a bond sometimes. It's important and a value. It's interesting that even though the job you were recalling is a ridiculously low amount of money on today's scale, on all cases, they still, at the time, we bought a PlayStation with it. We did something that was meaningful to our world at that point in time. And the rest, hopefully, the rest of our expenses were balanced. You know, I used to be able to move apartments in a pickup truck. You know, I could pretty much do that in a couple hours, right? And life has gotten more complex now. We can't do that anymore. I think that that we learn at every stage of our life, however, and that's why I asked what was good about those jobs. Even though they were low-paying jobs, we look back on them and we see some spark of value that we is part of the fabric of who we are now. And part of our experience base that makes us better at what we do now. So there's a couple of things from that are messages. One, we have people like that working around us right now. They are currently working in what will be their lowest paid job at some point in time. And we're the influences on them. We have the opportunity to make it a good job for them, a good experience for them, leave them with something that is more than they expected it, more than they thought they would get, something that they can mine as value later in their life. And so that's just a bonus if we can wind up doing that. That's a value for us to do. And that is something that sets us apart over time from the people around us. Those are leadership qualities, right? That's what gets us the spots in jobs where we make more money, spots in jobs where we have opportunities. Maybe we have an opportunity to partner with someone. Maybe we have an opportunity to design and develop and build and do something that launches a business or a product, part of a business. Maybe we have an opportunity to start our own companies altogether. Some of you in this room will do that. Some of you have aspirations that you want to do that. I've talked with you about that. And so we'll set the stage for that with some of the thought processes that are going to be necessary. We are talking predominantly about talent development and human resources, and yet we have only one person in the room right now that's directly working in the area of human resources. So for the rest of us, we're going to be learning about the world of human resources, and we're going to see that we're in that world even though we don't have that title in most cases. If we are in management or having a supervisory role, or if we are ownership, if we are owning a company, there's a lot of stuff that we're going to need to know about human resource development and talent development, because it's all about talent. It's all about talent. If I hire better talent, I win, because I have competitive advantage now. If I don't hire better talent, I have a rework factory, right? And I have to rework stuff, whether it's a service, customer service not being delivered, or tangible goods not being delivered. So talent's everything for all of us, wherever we're at. And the HR team is what helps us stay legal and helps us maximize the value of the talent we have and helps us keep that talent longer than we would if we don't have a concerted effort at it, because there's a hole in our bucket. People quit, people leave, and sometimes there's really good reasons why they do, and sometimes it's just a bad manager, and that's broken. You know, we shouldn't lose good people because of one bad egg that had a bad day, and we face that probably all the time. So to further the last introduction is me. I don't like to talk about myself a ton because I don't learn anything. I just, you know, I like to listen to other people talk. I prefer that. But it's fair to you that I give a little bit of a background of relevant things. The lowest paid job I had is, I say tongue in cheek, this one. It's pretty close. And that's okay. I came here to retire. Thought I could do that. That was 12 years ago, and I started writing curriculum for the college to help them do some things for people that have jobs. How can we develop courses and programs for people that can't go quit job and start their life over again and go to college? You know, how do we do that? How do we work that? How do we develop programs that can do that? So that's what I've been doing, and it's been kind of fun to do that. I still consult a little bit. I am an electrical engineer by degree once upon a time. You got to stay current in that to really be good. I'd have to say I'm probably not a great one now. There's too much stuff has changed since I went to college. All the software programming that I learned are languages you don't speak anymore. You know, Pascal, COBOL, Fortran, all these RPG, all these programming languages that don't even exist. So, you know, how do you stay valuable in something like that? I was in corporate management most of my career, in the medical field, a lot of that. I managed a plant in Munich, Germany, and I managed a plant in Beijing. I lived in Ireland for a couple of years. Ultimately, I was CEO of a company. We made diagnostic ultrasound equipment. Color Doppler was our claim to fame. And we manufactured cancer treatment equipment. So using ultrasound and microwave energy, we've got a $2 million machine at the University of Utah Medical Center is an example that's still there. It's probably obsolete now too, but that was the field that I was in. We had manufacturing facilities in China, in Germany, and in the U.S. The public company traded on NASDAQ. I had to report to the Securities and Exchange Commission. I had to write the 10-Ks, the 10-Qs. I was chief financial officer of that company for a while. Ultimately, I was chief executive officer of the company. And I left that company when I designed a device to scan for colon cancer. I put it in clinical trials in China. And while it was in clinical trials, a Chinese company offered me a stupid amount of money for the company, and I sold it, which was, I don't know if I was a good move or a bad move. It left me unemployed for a few minutes, and I had to kind of think that through and deal with that, and I started consulting by accident. During that period, a buddy called me up and wanted me to go work for him. I said, no, I don't want a job. And he said, well, will you come help us? And I said, okay, and I did, and I loved it. And what I loved about that was you could kind of get together with the leadership team or the ownership and say, you know, what's waking you up in the middle of the night? Where are you right now, and where do you need to go, and how could you get there? And so I got engaged with companies, a lot of brands small companies here in town. And I came through St. George quite a bit living in Salt Lake, and the local banks here, when they'd lend money to a company, if they thought the loan was getting dicey, they'd call a consultant and send me into the company and say, here, see if you can help them not lose our money. And that provided a lot of valuable training for me. And you can't get that in class. You just have to get it in life. And in my case, it was with somebody else's money, which is the most fabulous way to learn those lessons, is with somebody else's money. So I did consulting and still do a little bit for companies now and then. I just teach mostly and live here in town. And I came here by choice, thinking that this would be a fabulous place to retire. I was told that I would not like Utah at all when I moved to Utah. I'm a farm kid from Illinois, and farm kids grow up in areas that are green, and Utah is an area that is brown. And so when I came here, it was like, I don't know what this brown is all about, and I'm not sure that I like it. But it turned out I love it, and I decided that I want to stay here and retire here, and I'll teach as long as they let me. And it's getting to meet people like you and work with you that to me is the most valuable thing, is to watch people discover the skill sets that they have and see them be rewarded and get rewarded. And I think that, you know, we have an opportunity in life to help people around us, and we need to all of us step up and do that when we have those opportunities. So that's a little bit about me. I probably more than you needed to know, but your phone numbers are what I do, my phone numbers are what you do need to know. I'm trying to transition away from this cell phone number to this cell phone number. Put both of them in your system if you would, because I'm not sure how that transition is going to go. What happened, what started this whole thing was we were doing some statistical experiments on what cell phone service was the best and what cell phones were the best. I was teaching a class here at Dixie State and at Dixie Technical College and at Tooele at Utah State and at SUU in Cedar City. And so we were televising the class, and so I had people with phones in all of those markets. And so I gave everybody the same text message, the same photograph, and the same video clip, and I had everybody, we did a design of experiments where everybody sent the same thing to other people with different carriers and different phones and, you know, iPhones and Androids and different mixes, and we mixed it all up thinking that it's going to be pretty much the same. I mean, cell phones are cell phones. And what we learned is it's totally not even close to the same. I had video clips that I received the following day, in some cases, on my personal phone. So the top one is a Verizon phone, the bottom one is a T-Mobile phone, and I'm carrying them both for a while to see if there really is a difference in the towers here. T-Mobile had problems in the towers some years back here in St. George market. You know, national advertising is meaningless. I live here. I want to know what service is here. And when you look at most of the maps, Southern Utah is white, the white area on the map. You know, 99% coverage in the United States. We're the 1%. that doesn't have great coverage, just the way it is. And then to make it worse, when T-Mobile put their towers in here, it was about the same time that Nellis Air Force Base was gearing up their drone operations outside in the desert there. There's 9 trailers out there that they run all the drones in Afghanistan and in Ukraine right now, and they needed more bandwidth. And so the Air Force leased T-Mobile's towers, which made T-Mobile's service worse in St. George. And when Sprint got them and they put their assets together. Sprint had the largest installed base of towers at that time that were 5G technology. And so T-Mobile claimed that they're up there. And so I don't know. I don't believe them. Right? So I'm carrying one of eight. We'll see. If there's a difference in this market between Verizon and T-Mobile, I'll let you know. Sometime if you don't reach me on one, call me on another one, and we'll blame it on Verizon or blame it on T-Mobile. That's just a little experiment we'll have to unwind. And if you have information on that, that's factual information, I'm interested in that, because national marketing doesn't make a local market at all. And that's one of the things we talk about in management. So let me give you a brief overview before we do our active shooter, because I want to do that and we'll take a break. But brief overview, there are a couple of national and international tests that people that are in the HR profession, human resources profession, can get certifications on. And the content of this class is based on those materials. There are two main organizations. One is called HRCI certification, and you can look at this book. I don't remember what it costs, but it's a thick one. It costs a little more. It's got a scan code in the back. It's not required that you purchase it. That's the HRCI certification, and then there's another organization that's called, it's pronounced SHRM. It's a Society of Human Resource Management, and SHRM has a body of competency and knowledge, a body of applied skills and knowledge that are required. Their exam is called the PHR, and they offer that exam. The problem we have with getting those certifications for your knowledge, even though today you may not be working in HR, in the very near future you may be managing an HR team, you may be hiring an HR team, or you may decide you want to join one and be part of the HR team. The problem with the certifications are they require that you are employed as a HR professional. And so that means you have to have a business card with a title that says that's your job in order to get certified. And a lot of the jobs on Indeed require the certification in order to get you the job. So it's kind of a catch-22. It's like, how do you do this? What do you do? And by to get the certification to have a job, you have to be working You have to be working for 1 year as a professional human resources director level or higher, and you have to have a PhD. None of us in this room, I think, have a PhD. If you do, you didn't say so. You should have bragged about it a little bit if you do. None of us do. Or you could work 2 years as an HR professional and have a master's degree. Now, some of you in this room do have master's degrees. Or you could work 3 years as an HR professional and have a bachelor's degree. Now we catch more people. But with a high school diploma, you can't get this certification. That's a problem. But it's the way it is. So SHRM has a little bit more leeway in their certification, the PHR certification, on their study guide, but you still have to be employed as an HR professional. And that makes common sense to me a little bit. But the skill sets that are required doesn't require to be your job. The skill sets required are the same skill sets that's required to be a boss. Just to be a manager in a department in the back of the building, in a production setting, or to be in charge of the receiving team or the shipping team or the installation team or the delivery team. We're talking about talent development. Doesn't that happen everywhere in the organization, everywhere under the roof? It does. And so the skill sets required are for us. Whether we got your PhD or not yet, you may be working on it, and the skills that we learn here in this class are about people. How do we develop people? And in talent development, let me ask two questions without a PowerPoint on this. Whose talent are we developing?
Our employees.
Our employees, yes. Who else?
Ours.
Our talent. Because, you know, it's really of no value to develop everybody else's talent. Develop our own too, right? So that's what you're doing here, right? You're here because you're building your skill sets. You're reinforcing the knowledge base that you have, and you're going to draw on all kinds of information in order to make you better at your game. And if your game at the moment is not directly in HR, if you work with other people, the skill sets are the same. Identically the same. Now, there's a few labor laws that we will talk about that aren't necessarily a requirement to know if you're working out in a factory running a team, or if you're vice president of operations. They're not necessary for you to know. But I tell you what, if you don't know them, you can go to jail. And so they're very important for everybody in the organization to know, not just the HR people. There aren't a lot of those. I mean, there's a lot of law, but this isn't a law class. We're just going to talk about things like the stuff that gets you in trouble in an interview. And HR is not the only people doing an interview in most of the organizations that I experience here in Southern Utah. Most of the interviewing is done by the department or team or the boss that they're going to work for, and then HR blesses it and fills out all the rest of the details and makes sure that the drug test is passed and what other requirements there might be for employment at that particular company. So the ability of screwing up an interview is equally capable of being done by the big boss as well as the HR people. And y'all know there's questions you can't ask in an interview. Right? Y'all know that, right? You all know that. And so when you're waiting for, you've got to interview somebody and they're sitting there and you're making small talk with them and you say, are you married? You just broke the law. You say, you got any kids? You just broke the law. You say, I've seen that name before. What nationality is that? You just broke the law. When I first started working in St. George as a consultant, this will tell you how long ago this was, just by the question. Most of the job applications that I saw in St. George had a question on the job application, who is your bishop? True story. True story. Now, that's an illegal question if you didn't know that. Now, and that's nothing to say about whether or not you're religious or not and all that. We all know that stuff. But that was considered an innocuous question because it's a small community. They probably knew your bishop, right? And so it wasn't that they wanted to find out, are you of our religion? They just made an assumption you probably were. And that wasn't really what mattered as much as, do I know people you know? And so that was what was driving the question. It's as illegal as can be, right? We all know that. We've come a long way from that, and you aren't asking those questions. But it would be easy to ask a question about how many kids somebody has, and you just broke the law. And you didn't mean anything bad about it at all. In fact, you don't even care the answer. You don't care. You don't care if it's 0, 10, 100. You don't care how many kids they, well, 100 you might want to know. I don't think our health insurance is going to cover you, or something like that. I'm not sure. But anyway, these certifications, I'm going to leave these out. These two documents from SHRM are, I have PDFs. You don't have to buy anything to have those. And I will post those on Canvas. As soon as we have Canvas up and running, that'll be another class where we tell you how to get all logged in and signed into Canvas. That'll be where I'll have PowerPoints that we use, videos we use. They'll be up on Canvas, so you can refer to those on your phone or on your computer, and you can check out resources like this. And then specifically for any others that wind up working in HR, specifically while this course is going on, I will have a few one-on-one conversations with you about things that you're facing at work that we make sure we cover in class. So wherever gaps are, and we will have a few. I have three lined up guest speakers that will be coming in that work in the HR arena. One of them is an attorney, and so I'll prep you so we can have some questions, we can have some conversation when those events occur. So we'll have a chance to maybe learn some extra special things that we might want to dial into. Any questions so far? Good. Let's watch a video, and then we'll take a break. We'll be a little past the break, be about 7 o'clock. This is on a couple things that the college, we believe that at Dixie Tech, we believe that active shooters don't usually shoot at the police department. And why is because that's a hard target. We believe that active shooters typically look at soft targets, whether it's someplace that's not going to shoot back at them, at least right away. Even, you know, if it's like from the hotel in Las Vegas and into a concert venue across the street, that's a pretty safe distance. It's a soft target. It's not like going up to somebody and you punch them and they're going to punch you back. And so we want to make ourselves as hard of a target at Dixie Tech as we can. And by that we mean there are a couple of things that aren't intuitive but that you need to know as students. That one is you can carry a gun on this campus. There's a lot of thought in the back of your mind that you can't have a gun on school property. That may be true of your grade school if you're concealed, not open carry. Utah is open carry. You can go into your grade school with a gun strapped on openly. That's legal in Utah. They will watch you. They will follow you. And I'm not suggesting you do that. I'm just saying that is legal in Utah. It is legal on this campus if you have a concealed carry permit to carry on this campus. A year ago, Utah relaxed the law for concealed carry permit. Anyone is entitled to conceal carry if they don't have certain legal restrictions that don't allow them to because of a court order or something else that restricts them from firearms. And we know different places where that is a restriction. But for everyone else, if you're legal to carry a firearm, you can carry it here. We suggest you do. Our college teaches concealed carry permit training for all faculty and staff. They ask us to do that. They encourage us, if we are married or have a significant other, to have them trained as well. I am not taking a position on guns here. That's your personal view, and I'm not encroaching on that. You're entitled to that view, and I respect that. What I'm telling you is what the college's view is, and you should respect that as well. You're not required to participate and buy a shotgun. But if you can carry one legally, then we're saying do so. And why is we don't want some idiot that's mad at the school to come back here and go postal and start shooting the school up. We want people to know that our intention is to be a hard target, and we want to shoot back or have the ability to protect and stop the threat if we possibly can. And so that's a personal decision. If you aren't ready to help and to be part of that, that's fine. Don't tell anybody that you do or don't. That's your personal business. But if you are in agreement with that, then just quietly join the forces that are taking that position to protect us in the event that somebody goes crazy. It's senseless to have people die in schools because a gunman goes crazy. And I can assure you that in the Aurora, Colorado shooting where a guy stands up at the front of a movie theater and starts shooting, if you did that at the Stadium 8 in Hurricane, I am sure that somebody would have shot back. And I just feel that much, that's a requirement of our community in terms of defending ourselves, that we don't think somebody should senselessly take lives. So that's all I will say about that. The rest of this is whether you are carrying a weapon or not, you would be a victim if a shooter were to come into this room. And so what should we do? What could we do? Thinking it through beforehand is something that we want to do. So we're going to show a video that addresses this. These are law enforcement officers trained. We have training here on campus from St. George Police Department on active shooting every year that they come in, and I have heard AR-15s discharged in this hallway out here, and I've been to the firing range a lot. I've shot a lot. I know what it sounds like, and I didn't hear. It sounds like a nail gun. And if I was thinking somebody was just building a wall construction and I heard 2-3 shots, boom, 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 I would think it was a nail gun. I would not think it was a gun gun. And so the St. George Police says if you hear a boom, that's normal. if you hear two or three in a row, that's not, it's probably not fireworks, it's probably gunfire. And so being prepared to think about that, that's coming from our own St. George Police Department, which is interesting to me.
Active shooter prevention is more than a legal mandate. This is about virtuous leadership, recognizing a potential threat and preparing for it. Hoping that it won't happen to me is not enough. Hope is not a good strategy. It's clear from recent active shooter events that employers will need to provide some attenuating measures to protect their personnel from this form of workplace violence. The General Duty Clause, Section 5A1 of the Occupational Safety and Health Act, or OSHA, requires employers to provide their employees with a place of employment that is free from recognizable hazards that are causing or likely to cause death or serious harm to employees. Recent court rulings throughout the country have allowed negligence suits filed by victims of active shooters to proceed against employers for failing to provide defensive training to their employees. In other words, companies can no longer avoid their corporate responsibility to provide training on both how to spot potential active shooters and on how to react if so confronted. This is more than a simple calculus of risk reduction. It's about providing competent and effective protective training to persons in your charge. It is the essence of caring and virtuous leadership. The purpose of this video is not to alarm or frighten you, but rather to educate you on threat recognition and the appropriate steps to take if you find yourself in the vicinity of an active shooter. Hopefully, after watching this video, you will be able to better identify potential active shooters and report them before violence erupts. At the end, you'll be given a short 10-question quiz that will help ensure that you learn the right lessons from this instructional video. Remember, you must act quickly. Escape, hide, or attack if ever confronted by an active shooter. This training will help you act quickly and appropriately in the eventuality of an attack.
On a breaking story out of Aurora, Colorado this morning. A very scary situation in a suburban Denver movie theater. Apparently there has been a mass shooting. What we're hearing from the police.
A mall outside of Portland, Oregon tonight. When as many as 60 shots rang out, the scene of Holiday Americana turned into terrifying chaos.
We've been telling you this morning there's been a shooting at a school in Newtown. This is the Sandy Hook Elementary School.
Gunfire erupts in a normally quiet office complex. Scott,
news reports down in New Orleans, according to local news reports, at least 12 people shot at a Mother's Day parade there.
A gunman is dead after police say he opened fire at a McKinney Public Safety building.
We do know that one suspect is confirmed dead.
We had a tragedy that occurred here in our city, right from our public safety building, which obviously gets very close to home. None of our personnel on police or fire were injured during this incident. Very proud to say that.
If you're in the middle of an active shooter, Countermeasure Consulting implores you to do three things. You want to react. You want to understand something is happening. You want to escape. You want to get out of the building at all costs, and you want to survive. You want to do that for you, your family, and for others.
We cannot rely on the stupidity of our enemies because our enemies are resourceful, they're bright, and fight unfairly.
The active shooter probably has plenty of ammunition. The active shooter has plenty of magazines.
If we sit back and take the attitude of it'll never happen here, you've already lost. You've already become the sheep.
On the national average, it takes law enforcement 14 minutes to arrive.
Those 14 minutes are going to make a big difference between how many lives you're going to save versus how many are going to get lost.
This video is set up to help you mitigate those 14 minutes of what to do before law enforcement gets there. We don't teach police response strategies. We don't teach military response strategies. And we don't teach fighting strategies. We teach common sense approach to safety.
The key is you have to take action.
One of the events that took place that I was involved in was at the McKinney Police Department. Someone woke up one morning and drove to the McKinney Police Department with his white Nissan pickup truck that was filled with ammonium nitrate. He proceeded to pop a flare in the front of the truck, popped the flare and threw it in the trailer, and then ran across the street and fired 168 rounds at the front of the police department.
About that time, we see glass breakage. So we realized we were under fire by an active shooter from the outside and come to attack our police building.
While he's doing this, he's waiting for an explosion to happen, thinking the ammonium nitrate would detonate. However, he got the formula incorrect, but his goal was to trump Oklahoma City.
None of our personnel on police or fire were injured during this incident. Very proud to say that.
An active shooter is an individual who is going in to cause a great deal of harm to a group of people. The term shooter implies a firearm, but actually that's not one of the key components. And they will almost always choose the most vulnerable populations to go after.
They are not a new phenomenon. There is no geographic region that is excluded. Males account for approximately 75% of all offenders. 50% of attacks take place in under 12 minutes. 48% of incidents end by force, whether it's by police or citizens.
I think trying to profile an active shooter is like trying to profile a drunk driver. There are lots of reasons why people drive drunk, and it's really not relevant if you're on the receiving end. I'm more focused on what they do, because what they do has some consistencies. Why they do it has a variety of reasons, and unfortunately, we have seen that.
Usually, they feel that someone has wronged them, and they are trying to make it right by violence of action.
We have had people who've had some severe mental illness, or they have felt left out and they've decided to make a name for themselves.
And that's the only similarities that we can find so far.
That's why I prefer to talk a little bit about what they do. We do know that some of the best predictors of behavior is what people say they're going to do. So if someone says that they are going to commit a violent act, I would take them at their word and I would call the police. Most people who have violent fantasies do not act on them. Now you start putting things together, they have fantasies, they start writing down those fantasies, then they start collecting firearms and ammunition and come up with a plan of people they're going to kill. That's taking action. Only if a friend happens to pick up on it, someone that they trust, are you likely to have any idea that that's occurring. A long time ago, I was in Afghanistan, and it was when we had first gotten there. We didn't know much about it, and I was up in the second floor of a very rickety old hangar, and all of a sudden, the hangar started shaking, but I just assumed somebody was bringing in a large jet, and it wasn't until I gradually, slowly wandered back outside to see what was causing the noise that I recognized that we were in the middle of an earthquake. So I had done exactly the wrong things. I had interpreted it as a safe noise, not to be worried about.
The majority of people that I've interviewed after active shooters have all stopped and asked each other, is that a gunshot? Do I hear shots being fired? Did this just happen? What are we going to do?
You hear loud noises all the time, not, oh my goodness, that might be someone actually trying to kill people.
If you hear a gunshot, you don't want to stop and think, did I just hear a gunshot?
Three words I'd like you to remember are react, escape, and survive. React to the threat, escape from the threat, so that you can survive.
Must do something.
We spend a lot of time and trouble training people to do fire drills to get out of a building. So if you think about that, with all the emphasis that we give to fire drills and how deadly fires are, you see the challenge involved in getting people to recognize the threat with an active shooter.
If you hear gunfire, if you see gunfire, you may have some risks in your brain that you are trying to process in slow motion. You need to retrain your paradigm. If I think I hear a gunshot, I'm going to get up and I'm going to leave.
How do you train people to react in a way that's effective under high levels of stress?
Some people, they just don't know what they don't know, unless you've been in these situations before. You just don't know how you're going to react.
Even though in situations that are oftentimes openly perilous on their face, we're still surprised when something bad happened to us.
You know, in times of stress, you're going to rise to the threat. Well, you know, studies show time and time again, you don't rise to the threat, you default to your level of training. So under stress, if you're going to default to your level of training, you better make sure you have the best training possible.
If you remember nothing else, you must do something. People don't necessarily want to react. Let me not rush into this. Let me just see what's happening. This has never happened before. There's got to be something else going on.
I break it down. What would I do or what would I want to know when faced with one of these problems?
One is action versus reaction. The notion of action versus reaction that we must understand is that the bad guy always has the jump on us.
I see something and then I respond to it, understanding what it is. And those are called reaction intervals. And if you overlay that with the OODA loop, that if you are a threat to me, I have a certain number of reaction intervals I have to do.
Bad guy has already set up and observed, oriented, and decided when to strike us. They're just waiting to act. And that acronym is called an OODA loop. Observe, orient, decide, and act.
You present threatening behavior towards me, I have to understand that there is threatening behavior coming towards me. That's one reaction interval. For the average trained individual to respond to a threat requires about a second and a half.
That's an eternity in a firefight. It doesn't sound like much, but that's a big jump.
How far can an average person run in about a second and a half? 21 feet, 25 feet?
Preparation and practice.
Be prepared. Practice what you are thinking. Know where your exits are. Know where your entrances are. Know the other employees around you. Report suspicious behavior immediately.
Our decision that action versus reaction is often clouded by disbelief. Oh my gosh, is this really happening to me?
There's no need to panic when you're faced with a situation. You know what is going on, you know how to control, and you can deal with.
So that's the first lesson there.
The more information you have, the more data you collect and your ability to process it, the better decisions you're going to make.
Once you've realized that you need to take some action, you need to get out to escape.
In 2011, I was on vacation with my family. We were driving on Cape Canaveral Avenue towards Cocoa Beach, and my 14-year-old daughter looked out the window and said, "There's someone shooting an office park." Sure enough, there was a gunman engaged in a firefight with police, and there was a ton of traffic ahead of us. Literally, people just, what I like to say is stuck on stupid. They weren't in fight or flight mode, they were in stuck mode. We were in a rental car and we literally pushed our way out of the area, made a hard left turn into oncoming traffic, but we were moving away from the sound of the gunfire instead of moving to. At that time, in my mind, I was a father and a husband getting my family away from a gunman and not a policeman responding to the sound of bullets.
But you've got to evacuate yourself out of the danger area. You've got to move, and you've got to do that first. You have a family, you have friends.
Wait and see is not an option, because the more time you give a shooter, the more damage they're going to do. The mission of an active shooter is killing and executing people for no reason at all, with no worries about their own self-preservation or life.
It tells us that force is going to be required to stop this person. The odds of you having the force to do that are minimal. If you're sitting in an office, you are not prepared for that. You will be under a huge amount of stress when this occurs. So remember, run, hide, fight. 14 minutes is a very long time. Regardless of how far you move, by breaking out of that stasis of just sitting there going, "I wonder what's going on," A, you're thinking in your head, that slows you down. You need to be moving and acting.
In a corporate environment, there's a lot of closed-in spaces, and it's very hard to find an escape path. You should previously know where that escape path is after watching this training. If you know the exit is behind you and there's a shooter in front of you, you need to remain as low as possible while moving as fast as possible to that exit and escape. open environments or open spaces, the retail areas, like the Kansas Mall shooting. People were exposed to this active shooter that was walking through shooting people at random because they were stuck and just watching him. They weren't aware of their environment. They weren't aware of which direction to go to, and they had no training. And this is no fault of their own. No one ever taught them this information. If you're in these open area environments, such as a retail store, continue to move. You're less likely to be a target if you're moving. Because the shooter that's walking through any one of those areas I talked about is looking for the easy targets of opportunity.
You need to be moving and acting and getting out of the danger area.
That safety is behind cover.
Cover means protection from firearms. So cover isn't the same thing as hiding. It means that a cartridge, a bullet, will not make it through that cover to injure you.
During the incident, the McKinney Police Department, what he was trying to do was draw the police and the firefighters out so he could shoot them one at a time. What he didn't realize was the plume of smoke blinded him from the front of the department. Concealment. And when I use that word, it's a mask. Think of it as disguising yourself so you can't be seen. So a building or cinder block wall would be a good piece of cover. A glass window would not be cover. Once you're in a safe covered area, begin to use your phone. Call 911. What about my friend that doesn't want to come? You're gonna have to let your friend be. It's about self-preservation at that point in time.
The kids heard an explosion and they were reacting to what they thought was a fire. So they ran to another direction where another IED went off and it sent the kids back. And what it did was it bottled them back into the library where they were trapped. Only thing students were trained for was to get under a desk and wait for help. These two children ran around and hunted the kids under the desk and executed them one by one.
Stopping and doing nothing is similar to some footage that we have of Columbine High School shooting. We have students running one way, only to find out that it was a trap, because their goal was to end life that day and then end their own lives. So when we say hide is not your best option, it's because the people that are hiding are stationary targets. When you're dealing with this type of situation, you want to develop the mindset of survival. If you can't run and get out of the office safely or out of the open area safely, you will not allow this person to cause you damage and fail to let you go home.
The Department of Homeland Security says hide. And I don't disagree with that, but there are some real serious consequences that could occur from that.
The shooter at Virginia Tech just went and hunted who he wanted to shoot at will. The largest amount of deaths in one single place was in one of the classrooms where a professor tried to lock them in a room and wouldn't let them leave, and this person found that room that didn't lock, opened the door, and shot the professor first and then the kids.
That's why I prefer to talk about prepare to evacuate. So the entire time you're hiding, you're not hiding. You are planning, preparing to evacuate the danger area. You may temporarily have to keep out of the line of fire, but you're not going to stay there. And you never think about yourself staying there. While you're hiding, be prepared to move. That is not a permanent stasis, except under the most extraordinary circumstances.
When you know a gunman is outside in the corridor, you want to secure the view, you want to hide out of sight from them, you want to silence your cell phone and get down behind your desk and just be as quiet as possible.
It could take 45 minutes before the police are able to neutralize the threat.
Hide behind a wall, solid corridor that has a double lock cylinder. Behind a desk, remember to black out the shades, silence your cell phone, and try to remain there until it's safe to escape.
The probability of that person surviving just increased.
At all costs, should you not be able to do any of those things, don't become a victim and don't become a statistic.
Homeland Security says fight, and I'd be a little more aggressive and I'd say attack.
Gather a couple people and attack the shooter as violently and swiftly as possible to stop the threat.
Now, is that a good idea? No, it's a horrible idea. But it may be the best of some really bad alternatives that you have, realizing it needs to be as violent and as hard as you can. possibly can put forth.
We call it, in the military, field expedient weapons. In the police department, we use our utility belt. If you are in an office building and you are behind a desk and a shooter comes in and you have no safe way out, hit them. And don't stop hitting them until you survive. If you have a chair, hit them with a chair. If you have a phone, smack them in the head with a phone. If you can dive over a cubicle on top of someone and take them to the ground, yell for help and ask for other people to help you incapacitate the shooter. Hit the gun out of their hand. Hit them in the face. Hit them anywhere that you think it might hurt them. But you want to incapacitate the shooter as quickly as possible.
Attack with everything and everyone that you have.
The shooter will not stop until he inflicts as many casualties as possible. Make them the statistic. The law is on your side, and your family's on your side. During an active shooting event, there is going to be a time that police arrive. Whether it's 14 minutes or under or 14 minutes or later, they are going to show up. And when they do, there's some procedures that you need to follow. The first one you need to remember is you need to remain as calm as possible as you exit the building or as you're outside talking to the officers with as much information as possible, because they are responding to the report of someone firing a gun, and they don't know if that's you or someone else.
Your body is going to physiologically respond as it should, which is in a life-threatening event. Your pulse will go through the roof, your pupils will dilate, you'll start to sweat. You've probably read that you may have involuntary bowel movements. You may want to freeze, which is why we spend so much time telling you you've got to move. But then once it's over, well, you all of a sudden have this huge response to being safe. Some of that may be talking. Some of that may just be wanting to go up and talk to the policeman, touch the policeman, likely to get you into serious trouble.
Ever since the shooting at Columbine, the response tactics of police have transformed tremendously. Where they would used to show up, surround, create a perimeter, and call SWAT, now there's a less traditional approach.
We had mass casualties. We had propane tanks that went off. The children, I mean, they're ingrained in our minds. The children walking across the field with their hands up. And now, of course, we've got the tragedy in Connecticut, the most recent one.
Now the police show up. When the second or third police officer shows up on scene, they are entering your building. They're not there to repair the damage or fix the casualties. Even the people that are reaching out to them, please help me, please help me. They are there to stop the threat, which is the active shooter.
It's hard words, but it kind of drives a point home. Our job is to save lives. The ones that are injured, they're either going to survive or they're going to die. But why risk 50 more kids by stopping your advancement? In order to help these people, we've got to stop the threat. We've got to stop the threat or isolate it.
They don't know who the shooter is, the odds are. They don't know what he looks like. They don't know what he's dressed like. All they know is that there's someone in there killing people. So as soon as there is any chance of you being observed by the police, you need to do a couple of things. One is, if at all possible, stay still. Second is, make sure that your hands are able to be seen by the police. Policemen are highly attuned to looking to where the hands are and that they know that you are not one of the bad people. It may be possible that the police still don't know that for sure, so they might actually handcuff you. Be prepared to deal with that and do not fight it.
Be ready to corral yourself and your neighbors and your office mates in a safe area away from the active shooter if it's not resolved yet. And try to keep it as calm as possible, even though it's an incredibly violent account. The calmer you are, the better your chances are of surviving the incident. The most important thing is, do not go back until it's told all clear and safe to do so.
They're not there to treat wounded. They're not there to evacuate you. They're there to find that shooter and stop that shooter as soon as possible before he can kill anybody else. There'll be a medical team that'll be on their way. There'll be people to evacuate you out of there right behind them, but that's not their job.
Preparation. Practice.
I'll tell you that being involved in other active shooting events, the two as a police officer dictated a very specific response. The one as a civilian probably woke me up, because I knew that when my daughter said, "Dad, someone's shooting," I actually closed my eyes after we got through it and said, what would my wife do at work? What would you do at work?
The less you have to think about, the better. An office is not a place of a threat. Why would you ever think that an office is going to have a threat, going to have some risk involved with it?
If we sit back and take the attitude of it'll never happen here, you've already lost. You've already become the sheep.
It's that cognitive shift between a safe environment to recognizing that there is a danger. The active shooter is prepared. The active shooter probably has plenty of ammunition. The active shooter has plenty of magazines.
We cannot rely on the stupidity of our enemies.
The more information you have and your ability to process it, the better decisions you're going to make.
Must do something.
You want to react.
React to the threat.
You want to understand something is happening. Wait and see is not an option. Because the more time you give a shooter, the more damage they're going to do. If I think I hear a gunshot, I'm going to get up and I'm going to leave. You want to escape.
Escape from the threat.
You want to get out of the building at all costs.
Force is required to stop this person. The odds of you having the force to do that are minimal. So remember, react, escape, survive.
And you want to survive.
Survive.
You want to do that for you, your family, and for others.
If you remember nothing else, you must do something.
There is going to be a time that police arrive, and when they do, you need to remain as calm as possible as you exit the building. They're responding to a report of someone firing a gun, and they don't know if that's you or someone else. In summary, you want to be ready for an active shooter at all costs. You don't want to be a victim. You want to have a survival mindset. You want to know what actions you're going to take. You want to be aware of your surroundings.
We can never be too prepared to respond to the threat of a perpetrator that's going to come into our schools and do some harm to our children or our staff.
If you've watched this video, you should know where the exits are. You should have a predetermined escape path. But the key focal point is, do not stop moving until you are safe. Once you're safe, you have survived the event. The rest can be dealt with later.
We're going to take a break. Before we do that, let me just give a couple things. So, first of all, I hope this number is something we need to know. But it is something we need to know conceptually. And it is something you need to have a conversation with the people that you love the most, people you live with. They're a parent, you have children. Don't make anybody paranoid. That's not what it's about. Prepared is what we are looking at here. And the three things that they talk about there, reacting, knowing that there's a threat. We sometimes take way too long to figure that out. So what we want to do is run if we can, get out if you can, get away if you can, first, always, wherever you're at, whether you're here. This corner of the building, we're kind of trapped back here. It's not a good place to be trapped. It might be a good place to hide in the sense that a shooter might clear the rest of the building before they got here, but it's not a good place to be. It'd be better to be out, get your car, leave the campus. So run, that's the first thing. If you can't run, hide. And while you're hiding, make sure you're really hiding. So the lights are off on your cell phone, the ringer's not gonna ring. Do dial 911 if you can and do it without, just to make a connection in case nobody else has, but probably they have. More is just on the hiding thing. Hiding that where you're behind bullets, so you know, walls aren't very good protection. We want to hide in a place where we've got some safety. And during that hiding period, we're looking to see when can we run, or we are saying if all else fails, how are we going to fight? So if we were trapped in this room here, we'd want to take quick assessment. What weapons do we have in this room? Is anybody carrying a gun? Who is, where do we put them? Let's assume if there were no guns in this room, what do we have for weapons? Do we have a fire extinguisher? Do we have something heavy? Do we have something long that we can swing? You know, a healthy hands thing, you know, is going to hurt if that hits you in the face full swing. You know, we've got some things, a chair, a desk, what do we have? And so being prepared to fight, because if we have to fight, this is a fight to death for somebody. And we hate to say that, but we see it in the news. It happened in Trolley Square in Salt Lake. Remember that? Christmas time a few years back. It's happened close here. I've had over a dozen clients in the state of Utah. Companies have an active shooter in the company at some point in time or the other. Somebody running from the police and the police chases them through their factory. You know, they bail, ditch a car in the parking lot and they run through your building. A mad boyfriend coming back, or a mad husband coming back to the place of work to find, you know, who's messing around with his girlfriend or messing around with his wife, and they got a gun and they're ready to use it here in Utah. So it's not the same as what we saw over the 4th of July parade in Chicago, but it's something that should never happen, but it's something that we want to have some level of preparation for. That's the last we'll talk about of this in this class. This isn't a gun class. But please, go home and share something that you remember from this with your team at home, so that you're passing on some training. If one thing, you'll remember a little more of it, and you're better prepared, and you may be having the first conversation with someone you love who never thought about what would they do. You know, and having your mind made up of kind of what you would do is important if we have 14 minutes before the cops are going to get here. And so with that, we'll take a break. Look for the fire, for the exits when you go take a break if you want it. Say hi to somebody in the room that you haven't met before tonight. I know there's a bunch of new faces. So at least say hi. We'll be back here in 10 minutes, and we'll be on the short end of getting started in this course. So see you back in 10.
Huh? Yeah.
Stuff here. That's
I could defend this class.
Well, I'm glad to hear that. I'll help you. I'm not as good as you are, but I'll help.
I've done that class 3 times and I'm certified, but I have never beat their time clock. It's really fast, their test. I got 100% accuracy on my last test, which is hard, but I did not beat the clock. It's super fast. You have to do clear all these malfunctions of the gun, and you know, it's just a lot. But it's a cool course.
We've got a girl named Linda who is taking the CNC program over there, and she is ranked number one, number two in the country.
That's awesome.
And she's sponsored by a couple of the gun companies making some big guns and stuff. She's always got plenty of ammo because they sponsor. I've gone shooting with her a couple of times, and there's a range out here that Cobalt Kinetics owns the property. It's private, but they've got a door frame to practice kicking the door through.
Yeah.
And we had 100 yards away targets set up, 600 targets in 100 yards, and she had an AR. And I got video of her kicking that out and emptying a clip and not missing a shot. Just bam, 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 and she's hitting different targets every shot. And it sounded automatic, you know, she was pulling the trigger so fast that it just sounded automatic, and it's like, wow.
If you like guns, you should go check out the Front Sight course.
We've got a bunch of guys here that have gone, and they keep giving me
pass
to go. I just haven't done it.
Super fun, and they have like these houses set up where you go and clear the houses too. And it's funny how people react. I talked about that a little bit in there, but some people are paralyzed. Like, my husband was paralyzed. He had a panic attack before he even went in. I'm like, this is not real.
This is make-believe.
Yeah.
But I get it.
Yeah, and it's so funny how everybody reacts so different to the stress, even just of a simulation.
Yeah. So have you been to, is it Rick's? The new gun shop in town on Riverside?
Mm-mm.
They've got it.
Not Rowdy's.
No. This is a chop. He's a gunsmith. It's right over here on Riverside.
Okay.
They have a second floor that's got a bunch of those rooms and simulators in it.
Oh yeah.
And I think it's like $50 an hour. It's not prohibitively expensive to go get some training there.
Well, that's
I just
good.
Heard some guys telling about it, but I have not done it.
Yeah. When they have that gun club over in Hurricane at Purgatory that's supposed to be super fun, a lot of the people where I work do have their concealed and have done the training down at Front Site, but they have like steel target night there where people do competitions, and it's fun. We do have a lot of areas around here where people can go and learn, and Rowdy's is fun too to just go.
One of the things that I'm not an expert like you and haven't had training
I'm not an
like
expert
that,
either, but
but I care. I mean, it's, you know, but one thing that I have realized is I have never discharged any of my guns left-handed.
Oh,
it's
yeah.
Like, why not?
I know, and I'm left-handed.
Oh, you're left-handed.
But I shoot. I don't shoot left-handed.
You shoot
guns. Yeah.
You're right.
Mm-hmm.
But I haven't. It's like they're going, you need to train.
For
you know, the search and rescue guys and law enforcement, they all do it. But I just. And now ammo has gotten so expensive, you don't want to just
target shoot. I know.
Yeah, it's kind of hard. Front sight, you got.
You want to save it for when you're going to have to.
Yeah.
defend yourself.
How many rounds did you have to take on front sight?
800. No,
8,000. That's
good. 8,000.
8,000.
We shot for 4 straight days.
Wow.
Yeah, it was 8,000.
Yeah. Have you gone to front side?
No, but I've researched some of those kind of things.
Yeah.
I lost my mind from it. Yeah, it was more like 8,000.
Yeah, that's what I thought. That's, I mean, that is.
Because it was all day long shooting.
That is a lot of money.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
well, I think it was back when I did it. I haven't been for probably 4 or 5 years now, and I did it for years before that. I think it was about $600 for the ammo.
Well, that's not so bad. I mean,
mm-hmm.
that's
and you could buy there too, but. It's a lot more now.
Yeah.
And now I just want to hoard it.
I know. Just hoard it. That's true. That's what we want to do.
Yeah.
So as you come back in, we passed a sheet of paper around, and you all took a sheet out of the stack, and hopefully everybody wound up with one. I think it looks like everybody did. What I want you to look for is the two companies that you saw that you have there. Just, we're going to share something that popped out at you. You're not going to read that to the rest of us. You got to tell the name of the company and something that seems to be kind of interesting or cool or you scoff at and go, I know this company and that's not what they're doing. You know, did you get one? Yeah, you do. Good. Okay. Is the, you know, Zion Bank says, we haven't forgotten who keeps us in business. And on their drive-thru and their lobby and on their ATM screens. And I'm not so sure that I think some of them have forgotten who keeps them in business. You know, so you may read something there that you go, well, I'm not so sure about it anymore. But we got to go around the room and hear a thing or two about the sheet that you took, that you selected in the company. And as we look at leadership, you know, understanding values is something that is part of the original indoctrination that we want our HR team and us, if we are at the front line of hiring, we want to be the mission force, if you would, that gets a new hire introduced to our company. What is our company about? What do we do? And companies like to publish things like you went through and looked at, they teach everybody that. And they try to live that. And those things are the things that may set those companies apart from their competitors. So we've got two more minutes before everybody is supposed to be back. And if you'll review that a little bit, we'll have a little bit of discussion about it. And then I want to go through.
Thank you. may have heard that our company has been accused of unethical business practices.
Is it because of the falsified product safety tests?
Is it because of the false stories planted in the media about our competitors?
Is it because of our crime family connections?
What? Are you saying those things are unethical too? This thing is just snowballing. Now, where was I?
7 years ago. During the summer.
Ah, the heck with it. Senior management has decided to confront this head on and deal with the ethics problem directly.
They're surrendering to the authorities?
One might think that, but one would be wrong. No. They're sending all employees to mandatory ethics training classes.
Including managers such as yourself, correct?
No, Ashok, that wouldn't be very managerial, would it?
Correct me if I'm wrong, but hasn't every ethics violation in this company been perpetrated by managers?
Yes, but the point is managers are far too important to waste their valuable time taking worthless classes. That's what subordinates are for.
Gilbert always gets it right. We're going to talk a little bit about ethics, but that's our first topic. We'll introduce the topic tonight. Leadership ethics is really what we're going to be targeting on for the first class session coming up on Tuesday. The handout that you've got, who wants to go first and say something about the sheet that they got and tell us a little bit about the company that they read about?
I guess Luke.
You got it, Luke.
All right. I got Visa. Pretty much everybody has Visa. I do. I remember a while ago I listened to this thing. This guy said he was supposed to be a millionaire, and so he was doing this interview, and he said he has $0. All his millionaire was he had tons of credit cards, used all his stuff on credit, and lived as a millionaire just on credit. But you do it the right way. So Visa has always kind of looking up as their what we do. We connect people, we help people. People get behind on payments. We know there are people in people's lives, and trying to connect millions of people around the world to the rest of the millions of people around the world. In my dealings with them, I feel like Visa does actually pretty good. I think that they their system, how their system's set up, obviously it's which company is providing the Visa does a lot more to it than that, but Visa itself will back you on a lot more things than your actual bank. If you use your debit card as a credit card through Visa, Visa will back your charges more than your bank will. I feel like Visa is pretty good.
Okay, so they kind of live by their value. What were you going to report on?
So I got a Quick Trip. I picked them because back in Kansas City, it's a gas station. It's pretty much almost like Maverick. But to me, at least, I love Maverick, don't get me wrong, but Quick Trip is a lot better. They got the same they got the same ideas where they got Bonfire, Maverick, and Quick Trip, they call it QT Kitchens. They got a lot more options there, QT Kitchens, though. But I was reading their core values, and it seems pretty right on target. Do what's right for Quick Trip, focus long term. I thought it was... kind of right on the teeth.
So you're looking at frontline employees, mm-hmm. and somehow they've been indoctrinated, and they're doing that.
And they show even another thing that, focus long term, I guess, on their name tag. I just remembered it. They have their name and then how long they've been there for. So there'll be, and I think that's actually can be a good thing. There'll be somebody that's there for 8 years. So focus long term.
Recognizing people. Who wants to go next? Jake?
Full of creativity and learning. My son plays with them, I play with them, they're generational. They donate tons of products to schools, and STEM organizations, and things like that. With the Lego Masters on TV, watching that, and then we watched a few things on Netflix about toys that we love, Lego is one of them. The
I've seen the patent drawings on the Lego, and it's like somebody took a toy and made an empire out of it instead of just having it mass produced in some sweatshop somewhere far away. They've made a lot more than a toy out of it as a company. What an interesting leadership thing that they've done. Who's going to go next? I see two hands. Brad, I saw yours first, and then Jill.
I think I know two of the three companies. I don't work with QuickBooks. I know some people do. It's Intuit, but I do have TurboTax. I've been using it for years. They're good. They offer audit protection. If you do losses or gains, the IRS will come after you. TurboTax will take care of it for you for a fee, of course. And then they also run Mint, and it's you can log into your bank accounts with them if you trust them. They're pretty trustworthy, and it'll tell you when you have your upcoming payments. You can go and set a budget, and then you can log into everything like your health savings account, your 401k, and it'll tell you like your investments, your loans, when your bills are coming up, how much it'll be, and how you're doing for the month, and you can sort of see where you're spending more and less. And it seems like a pretty helpful program. I use two of them, but I just don't use QuickBooks, so I don't know too much about it.
Okay.
I got Amazon. It's a no-brainer. They're one of the most successful companies in the world right now, and I feel like I'm a big part of that. but what I noticed in their what they had written here, I specifically looked at. It says they hire and develop the best, and it says they raise performance bars with every hire and promotion, recognize exceptional talent, and willingly move them throughout the organization, develop leaders, and take seriously their role in coaching others, which is something that I think our company could do. And that's what he's there for, that I found out then. So moving, and I think that's where we get stuck, is we leave people at the same place for life, which,
yeah.
You know, I feel like we need to be moving people around and raising them up and giving them ways to thrive.
Many of us, when we feel our career is hitting a wall, we bail, mm-hmm. because there's no future there. Where can I go? What can I do? I've achieved what I can achieve. And if the organization doesn't offer some path forward or assistance forward, they're asking to lose their talent.
It's not always, the way that our company looks at it, they look at it as the bottom dollar, as a money thing. It's not always that. It's a life. Like, it's your brain. It's the way that you want to live your life. It's a lifestyle.
That's true. Next. I'm going to start drafting pretty soon here.
All told.
And why don't we do this? Why don't we, Eli, you're up.
Might as well get it done, right? So I got AdInBev, which is a brewery. It's always nice to have one after work. The one that I got that I thought was a really noble goal is we recruit, develop, and retain people who can be better than ourselves. We will be judged by the quality of our team. I just think that's something that I think everyone needs to work on. I think it's not just about how good can we be now. I think if you want to create a legacy, a lasting an impact, you need to develop the talent that you have and recruit as much good talent that you can.
Am I right that this is the brewery that actually owns Budweiser?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's not just a brewery. It's a big, giant.
Oh, massive.
Yeah, massive. One of the biggest ones in the world. I'm going to go behind you, and then we're going to skip Jake. We'll go to Eric. We'll go down the row like this. So, you're up.
I got Twitter. Because I'm talking to Kyle. One of their cores is to grow their business in a way that makes us proud. So, always we're growing in the direction that they're not.
That's an interesting management decision, isn't it? It's grown in a way that makes us feel proud.
Mm-hmm.
I think we define that differently, probably. But I can engage in that emotionally. I can get, okay, yeah, let's talk about what makes us proud. That's kind of a cool lever.
So I got Boeing, and the one I liked about it was integrity, and it says, you take the high road by practicing the highest ethical standards and honoring our commitments, and we take personal responsibility for our own actions. And I think it's good when anybody can take responsibility for
their own actions. You're right, and Boeing's had to do that in a couple of cases where they were betting the farm. They had to ground their fleet of 737s recently, the 737 Plus or Super, whatever they call it. They grounded it to change the software on control system because it was the one that caused the plane to crash in the Hudson River. And it was a design defect, and they owned it. They didn't wait for the government to yank them out of the air or more people to die. They owned it. They stepped up and did exactly what they're saying they were. It cost them a lot of money. And that's where you really check your ethics there. That's where it proves out your mettle. Are they just words, or do we really mean it? Do we live this? What'd you pick?
So I pretty much just found one that I was familiar with both, and now I kind of regret that because I think there's more interesting ones in there. But I got the Container Store, and I think women are going to appreciate this one a little bit more than most of the men here. But it says, intuition does not come to an unprepared mind, you need to train before it happens. And then our extensive training coupled with our employees' life experiences allows them to intuitively solve all of our customer storage and organization challenges. So I don't know if you guys have been in the Container Store, but there's freaking everything you can think of.
And all it is just boxes.
Yeah.
You know? And,
yeah.
And they're making bank off of those because they're addressing problems, and it's not just a box they're selling. They're selling a solution to your problem.
Right.
You're junked up, and we're going to help you unjunk, you know? And that's basically what they're targeting and having fun doing, which is kind of interesting that you could take something, manage that, and pull a team together to do that. You're up.
So I got Toyota. It says, create and develop advanced technologies and provide outstanding products and services that fulfill the needs of customers worldwide. I picked the Toyota ones, kind of a Toyota family. We've all had Toyotas. I drive a Prius, but I don't really know what to say about it. I'm not happy with Toyota right now, though. My car's just being, it's kind of a money pit at this point, but.
Well, we've talked a lot about Toyota in operations management and following the Toyota practices. And Toyota is certainly a benchmark as a company. They do a lot of things well. And as we study the company, we can value them, and hopefully they'll get your Prius back on the road and fixed, because I always need a Prius in front of me just to kind of keep me safer. I think is what that does.
I've had way too many bad experiences in Starbucks. Like, I don't know that anymore. But the one that stood out was creating a culture of warmth and belonging where everyone's welcome. Every time I've gotten one of the workers is picking a fight with somebody over race, belief, something. Every single time. Basically, delivering our very best in all we do.
So what struck you about Ferrari?
I'm a car guy, so I'm into it, and I'm just reading up. And for one, their list is a lot longer than Starbucks, and they've been more into it. And one of them says that they make sure to add character and soul to every piece of metal that they put together.
Yeah.
I think that's very true.
When you bought yours, it's a piece of art, right? It really is. And as a company, you have to have that mindset. You know, if you're going to sell $1 million car or $6 million car, you've got to deliver more than just a set of keys. You've got to deliver a lot, a whole package of value, most of it which is intrinsic. You know, and so that's very interesting. You've nailed something about Starbucks. We're watching a morph happened with Starbucks as in our country, and we're seeing exactly it modeled here in the St. George market. We have three direct stores here that are getting absolutely pummeled by the Dutch brothers, and they didn't see it coming. They didn't prepare for that. They own this market, and when we talk about culture. And company culture and you know, HR, part of what HR does is help the company mirror the culture to the new hires, the new employees, and so we have to identify the culture. An organization will have a culture whether they drive it or not. They will accidentally have a culture if they don't pay any attention to it. And that one usually is not one you want. You usually will regret that. So we see cultures, we see three Walmarts in our marketplace. I've talked about this in previous classes. Some of you may remember this. We go to those three Walmart stores here in Bloomington, in Telegraph, and in Hurricane. Those three stores are not the same, are they? There's an interesting commentary I would get from us if we spent a few minutes talking about the differences between those three stores. Now, the layouts are slightly different. The SKU numbers, Telegraph has the most SKU numbers, Pioneer Road has next, and Hurricane has last, in terms of the fewest products in stock. And the floor layout's a little bit different. The racetrack that they call the where you walk on the main aisles is different in the all three stores. The Telegraph is the more traditional one, but they've jacked that one up now, badly jacked it up. And it's in the process now. We're going to watch and see what happens. They've taken a bad store and made it worse. They've changed the pharmacy, and they changed the health and beauty aids, and they've consolidated lots of the dry goods in the store, and they've opened up by where automotive was. They've opened up a secret warehouse in the back there that is their online response team. So it's warehousing for online. They're hoping to catch up with Amazon. They want to get you to order Walmart. They want us to stop going to Amazon for stuff. And so they're trying to stock more stuff in the local storage. So they've taken retail square footage and put it into online square footage in this store. I personally think that's a bonehead move. I don't think that will work well for Walmart. They are the largest corporation in the world, so who am I? They may see things that I don't see there. But beyond that, cleanliness of the stores. If you were to rank the three stores in cleanliness, I know how you would rank them, and that's crazy. Why is that? Why should they all be the same? But they're not. If you were to rank attitudes of the people that work there, you won't see the same culture at those three stores. And part of their enemy is they've gone to a HR plan of bringing more temps in than they've ever brought in before. So they bring people in that are not part of the culture of Walmart. And that's probably a mistake from a management point of view. And they're doing that more on Telegraph rather than the other two stores, but they're doing it all three places. And this is just a snapshot of Walmart corporate. You know, this is one small market.
I think Hurricane is the most beautiful Walmart around.
It's windy.
I know, but you look at it, it's so nice. I rate the Walmarts too.
I will drive out of my way to avoid Telegraph, you know, in different. Okay.
And I got hired on right before this. A surplus of people got hired right before they started remodeling. It made everything so much worse.
It smells like the sewer.
When I got hired, my process was like, can you carry a 40-pound box? I'm like, yep, I'm going to kick it. Show up on this day.
Yeah.
There was nothing else. There was no training. It would show up. We're going to tell you you're going to do this.
We'll touch base with you off and on because you got some inside information about what's going on there. And it's very interesting to watch this happen because these are good companies, right? We do business. We want to do business with the companies. Back to your Starbucks, though. Starbucks has a different culture at the three stores. And the employees that are working at one don't want to go to the other. And they will if they have to, of course, just to keep your job. But they don't like it. And you go, why should Starbucks not be identical culture at the three stores? And, I mean, if they're not careful, Starbucks in this market is just becoming a Tesla restart charging station. And, you know, and they sell a few cups of coffee in the process of doing that. And so it's going to be interesting. It's not a place to hang out like they are saying they want to be. And it started out as a place to hang out. And, yeah, you could buy coffee if you wanted to, but they were okay if you didn't. You could go in there and you could interview people. You could screw around on your laptop. You could just hang out at Starbucks, and it's a lot less friendly. That they took the tables away for one thing, in most of them, so that you can't really do that. And we're going to see what happens. Dutch Brothers, what do you think about just from the outside looking at it. Anybody work at Dutch Brothers? So what do you suppose target market is? Starbucks target market and Dutch Brothers target market in St. George. What would you guess if we, are they the same target markets?
No.
No.
Starbucks is college. Dutch Brothers is probably retirees.
Working, get there, go grab a cup of coffee and get to work.
Okay. So we instantly said they're not the same market. They're not targeting the same market. But we didn't agree on how we read that. The Dutch Brothers is targeting more millennials, not retired, and they're too expensive for retired. A cup of coffee at Starbucks for many, many years is $1.80 for a cup of coffee, but nobody ordered a cup of coffee. At Dutch Brothers, they don't have coffee on their menu. You cannot order a cup of coffee. They don't brew coffee there. Which is like, whoa, wait a minute, hold on. It's a coffee shop. You can't get a cup of coffee at the coffee shop? Nope, that's not their market. They sell sugar. And so, you know, you gotta get something that's gonna taste good. I'm not dissing them, I'm saying we have laboratories right here in front of us, don't we, of how companies are managing well, how the jury's out. I don't know if Starbucks will lose their position here. I would not wanna own the Starbucks stores here unless I had some real ability to go in and change them, because there's problems brewing with Starbucks here, and actually their stock price shows that there's problems brewing with Starbucks in many places. Their model is changing. They're the first in. They probably have the ability to survive. We'll watch and see. Who else did we got? Andrew?
I went with Home Depot because I recognize.
Because we all go to Home Depot.
But the one thing that really stands out for me is taking care of our people. And they talk about, you know, the key to their success is treating people well. They do this by encouraging associates to speak up and take risks, by recognizing and rewarding good performance, and by leading and developing people so they can grow. And that's what we try to do at Wiley Wallbeds,
mm-hmm.
Right?
Careful, Larry.
That's what we want to do, right? We want to encourage an opportunity. If an employee, a frontline employee, sees a problem and they bring that to us, we want to be able to assess the situation and say, you know what, that's absolutely correct. We'll get this fixed so that it is easier for you to do your job. And when we have employees that are hurting, in their personal lives, we want to try to step up and help out and do what we can for them.
That's awesome. That can make a company all by itself, just that. That sets the company apart enough that when we recognize that, that makes it, it's not about just making cabinets and walls. It's about a whole different thing, and that's important for a company.
I guess Nestle, and pretty random, but some of the things that are sticking out to me, like there's some of the things we're trying at Wild, with our new tack times and procedures, but for management results, grow talent and teams, and lead to win. And I think that's what we're striving to do. With all the management and our team leads that we've gotten on board with this.
Yeah. Now, as we look at companies like Nestle that are worldwide companies and are as big as they get in the food industry for Nestle. We have another company in town, and that's Luke's company. Luke, not your private company, but Dairy Farmers of America is competing against Nestle. Nestle is arguably the largest ice cream manufacturer in the world. And Dairy Farmers of America is a big ice cream. How many trucks do you fill a day here in St. George? What's your capacity? Do you have any idea?
Probably close to 15 to 20.
Semi trucks per day.
We do about 175,000 units in 24 hours.
175,000 gallons of ice cream. It's not a gallon, they lie about that part.
They call it a unit.
Yeah.
Some are 3 gallons for Baskin Robbins, and
okay.
The other ones are 1 gallon, and the yeah. Other ones are. 48 ounce
ground. So 175,000 units, which could be, and by the way, you make all Baskin Robbins ice cream. That's a secret that you can't tell everybody that because Baskin Robbins doesn't want to know. But if you like Baskin Robbins ice cream, it's made here. So competing with Nestle's is these guys. And so when a competitor is holding the bar up there, what do you have to do if you're going to win? You've got to hold the bar at just as high. And you're in a plant that hasn't been holding the bar that high, and there's scrambling to be done to try to raise the bar. Because if you're going to win or hold your own against Nestle or keep a Baskin Robbins account, you've got to be up there, not just with quality, but the whole game behind it and the whole organization. So, and you've got a team that's working on it. It's a hard thing to do, but you got a team that's working on it. So that's kind of cool. I didn't cut you off, did I?
No.
Oh, okay. You've read. Everybody done?
Yep.
Okay. Nobody snuck through. We've got enough time. I want us to talk about how Harvard uses case studies. And we just used some case studies, didn't we? We talked about several companies, and you've got a stack in front of Brad there of the rest of those pages of paper. On your way out, if you want to grab a few, randomly grab a few and take them with you, take them home. I'm going to post up all 96 of those on Canvas, so you'll have them all. You can print them that way or look at them if you wanted. It's just interesting as a snapshot of companies that we know, kind of what they've spent the money and they've had the executive retreat, they hired a consultant, they came up with a page full of stuff. And some of those companies really live that page full of stuff. And that sets them apart in a way that that they can not just compete but be competitive. Don't talk and text or put your password in at the same time, because I'm pretty sure I know my password. All right, we're going to look at a 10-minute video and then talk about it with how Harvard uses case studies in their classrooms. Listen to some students talk about it. And my hope is that we can kind of mirror this as we talk about various examples throughout the course.
Today, we put ourselves in the shoes of Cynthia Carroll. Imagine, you've become CEO of one of the world's largest mining companies, Anglo American. $25 billion in sales, 162,000 employees, two-thirds of them in South Africa, and 4 months into your job, you hear the news. One of the miners in Rustenburg has lost his life. Yet another fatality. You have to decide, are you going to shut down the mine or continue business as usual? David, if you can open for us today. You're Cynthia Carroll. The news comes to you. Do you shut down the mine in Rustenburg? Yes or no? What are you going to do?
So I think she needs to initiate very detailed investigations into what happened in these circumstances and then what has happened throughout the past.
Are you going to shut down or not shut down?
So I'm going to do a detailed investigation. And when I do have a plan.
What are you learning? What are you learning in this investigation?
Practices that are not being followed correctly or out of line or could be safer where there's like...
People are dying, it's not safe. What evidence are you looking for?
When you get the opportunity to participate, you need to be able to compact the information that you're going to present in a very concise and clear manner. Through participation in class every day, this is something that I am trying to sharpen.
Who wants to get in on this?
It's dynamic, it's fast-paced, there's a ton of energy. Everyone's really excited to jump in and contribute.
I learn a lot from my peers as much as I learn from the faculty, if not more. The professor kind of facilitates, it's like an orchestra, they kind of direct the music, but they're not necessarily playing it.
I think we need to shut it down. Miner deaths are accepted as just a part of the process of mining. Shutting down the operation would signal a very strong mentality shift that deaths aren't going to be tolerated.
That's called a bold stroke, by the way. What Grant is talking about, what Zosa is talking about, what Robert is talking about, is a bold stroke, which means from this day forward, something has shifted. But those of you who disagree say what? Those of you who disagree say what, Will?
I think we do much more if we improve the culture around safety in the entire organization.
There's some truth that we're trying to work toward. The debates become more and more fun because that's when you get to uncover views that you hadn't thought of and when you get to push your own thinking and hopefully make your own thinking much, much better.
If you allow your perspective to be constructively challenged by other people, then it is just fascinating how, you know, your position and your perspective can shift.
Those of you who want to shut down, how do you respond to this? Layla.
We shut down the plant because we had safety issues, and we made a stand, and we started making a safety culture, like we had a safety culture.
The fact that we can have difficult, uncomfortable conversations, we can talk about race, we can talk about politics, and still be friends at the end of the day, and to have people who are not from a specific group, but still have sympathy and empathy is pretty unique.
Beyond cultural and beyond structural, we also talk about the people of the organization. The overseers are generally white and the workers are generally black. The language they communicate is called Magala, and it's largely a command and control language.
So you're saying some structural, you're saying some linguistic communication barriers, you're saying some organization cultural issues around the entire organization.
I think the Smither also gives you humility. Your perspective is not enough to figure out the answer to a question, and actually gives you the ability to ask other people what their perspective is.
So there's 27 countries represented in our section of 94 people, and because of the way that the case method is structured, we can sort of get underneath what are those differences really tied to. You know, are there cultural things about where you come from that makes the business world operate slightly differently, and are there things that we can learn from those differences?
I think consumers are critical here, so not only do they care about having high quality inputs to their supply chains on time, but they will also care about safety. In the first month or couple weeks of class, I was hesitant to participate, but over time, I've gotten rid of all of my barriers and don't really have any qualms about participating, but a lot of that is because of the support of my classmates. And not only do I see it changing in myself, but I see my classmates making better points over time, which then also, again, pushes me to be better.
Stakeholder analysis is so, so important when we think about change. So important to do. We think about who do we need to worry about and what do they care about? What are their interests? And so you start there, but that's not enough. You have to then say, where do I need to invest the most time? Who is in this cell? The board.
I'm really worried about the managers.
I think the government's also key in here.
Being in the case setting, you realize how valuable everyone else around you is and how valuable their opinions are and the importance of being a really good, active listener.
So before we shift from this and think about some action planning, I just want to show of hand, because it's not clear to me. In this room, how many of you are shutting down? Really? And how many of you are not shutting down? So most of you are not shutting down. Wow! So are we going to resolve this now, or are there points that we need to make?
I don't know if I think this is a performance gap. I don't know if this is about best practices. To me, this is about culture. If all these minors were like white and not black, I think the death rates would look very, very differently, because I think people would consider the value of the lives of the people in the mine very differently. The question we have to ask is this company extracting more value from the community than it's providing?
It's scary to be vulnerable in a working world, so you're oftentimes taught to put up a shield. But here, you're given an environment that supports you to take those risks and actually celebrates failures or celebrates diversity of thought when you don't agree with someone.
Jumping into the arena, using your brain to come to the best hypothesis and conclusion that you can given the data that you have, is a task that leaders have to do every day. How do you use limited information to make a decision and do that in a way that forces you to flex that muscle of dealing with ambiguity?
They don't get it. Jake.
Yeah, in dragging it back up from the front line to the CEO position, one of the things that I was thinking about, it's not just all of these different elements that you should be considering in terms of safety, but also the leadership capability of Cynthia herself. You reliably took positions at your previous company that were incredibly unpopular,
and encountered all sorts of resistance. And I think this is a case where you've shown that you could do it, and so I would shut down the company.
The situation is different, don't you think? Is she suited for this job? Can she do this?
I think that's an incredibly challenging question.
That's what we do, Jake. This is what we do. This is what we do. We push students to take a position or to take a stand because it forces students to think deeply, to think about risks, to think about the weaknesses in their ideas, and to also be open to influence. I want them to set high standards for themselves. I want them to be challenged. I want them to challenge others.
So what initially brought me here was that I wanted to complement the skills that I've developed in architecture and consulting with business skills. But once I got here, those priorities completely changed. What inspires me now is really the having super engaging discussions with my peers. I don't think that I've ever been that intellectually stimulated on a day-to-day basis as I am here. And I think for me, that's inspiring, and it just wakes me up every day with excitement. I think I recognized that I wasn't pushing myself to think differently or to lead differently. I wasn't going to do anything extraordinary. And I thought maybe if I came here, I would be pushed in a way that would lead me to develop into someone who could change something. At HBS, there's just no one here who wants to come out the same way they came in. And that's really exciting.
30 years ago, Cynthia Carroll, 30 years ago, was actually in your seats, in these exact same seats. And because of her, thousands and thousands of minors in the world are paid better and much safer and are leading better lives with much more dignity. One day, not only that could be you, I know that one day it will be you.
We are going to not be harder. We're in Southern Utah, we're in a better place. I've been to Cambridge. They got muddy water, muddy river there. Ours are better. We are going to use that in this class discussion like that. We've already done a little bit today. We didn't have the CEO sitting there in the room and saying, is she qualified for the job? That's a pretty tough question, right? She was sitting there. And she is the CEO of a billion-dollar company, $25 billion company. And so we won't have that privilege. We won't put anybody in a spot like that. But in terms of talking about, what do you think? Should they have closed that plant down, the mine down, or should they operate the mine? We have difference in this room. You think closed. You think open.
You have to keep it open to figure out what happened and then correct it.
Okay.
If you close it, nothing gets done.
Why close it?
Close it to do the investigation to find out what happened. It shows the other people you care about, your employees.
So maybe not close it forever.
Right.
Close it for a minute.
So
suspend operations until we figure out and implement and put some stuff in place to keep people alive?
Yeah, put a team together, close it down, put a team together and run it and watch it.
Okay. A lot of options on what the way
about
to do that.
Like a moment of silence type thing. Like shut it down, let everybody know, hey, this happened, even in their other minds. Hey, over here in this other time, this guy just died. You need to take a minute, think about your life, think about what you're doing.
Think about your safeties. We have a global issue with safety, don't we? I mean, all of our companies have safety. All of our safety challenges. All of our companies have safety issues. We have people in St. George that die at work every year, more than you would think. And that's not okay. We all have the expectation of going to work and going home as we same way we went to work. So when things happen, do we just respond? Somebody bled, somebody died, so now we pay attention, but it'll go away in a few minutes. That fatigues a culture, doesn't it? When we do that, the theme of the day, or you know, we're going to have a tailgate meeting because somebody went to the hospital, and so you know now we're going to respond, and but it's not genuine or not real. Shutting the plant down sends a message to a lot more people than the miners down in the hole, doesn't it? That sends a message to who else?
Families.
Families? What about the bank that they owe money to? How are you going to pay that money back? All of a sudden, this is more important than satisfying our corporate debt or reaping a corporate profit for this period. We got to fix this. That's what that says. Now, if we can't fix it and we shut it down, we now have let down our shareholders who are paying us to run the thing correctly. And so now we have an additional dilemma to talk about, don't we? You know, of how are we going to do that? Because our job wasn't necessarily firsthand to keep everybody alive. I mean, that was probably implied, but probably wasn't even really in the job description, especially in South Africa. Not that lives are worth less there. The culture is different there. I've had a client that drills oil in all over Africa, and we were having some issues, safety issues there. The drilling teams got a pay differential if the country they were drilling in was at war, meaning they're getting strafed by fighter jets on drill sites, and they're getting shot at, and so they get combat pay for drilling oil. So what do you think about that? How do you think about sending a team in to a country where they're at civil war and you're going to drill anyway because you've got a customer in London that's paying you to explore for oil? What are you going to do? This is an ethics question, isn't it? So what we found out was quite interesting. In one case, and then I've documented in one case, and then I found out it to be replicated, the crews knew they got combat pay if there was the country didn't have to have declared war. If there was gunfire in the neighborhood, police response or military response in the neighborhood, their pay got kicked in. So what happened is the drilling crews were hiring mercenaries to come shoot at their containers while they were drilling so they get more pay. Now think about that for a few minutes. Wow. It's like, whoa. How are you going to manage that? What's rotten in the culture there? How do you fix that? Business is interesting, right? Stuff comes up and you go, I wouldn't even believe that was a possibility. But it wasn't just a possibility, it was real. It was happening. And the guy that was masterminding the whole thing has retired from that company now, and he lives in Kayenta. I know him pretty well. We could go talk to him, bring him in class and say, what made you think of that? Well, his first answer when I did ask him, his name's Larry, sorry about that, his first answer was, well, I wasn't the one getting shot at. And I'm thinking, okay, that maybe makes it different. So expect everything when we talk about ethics and business, right? We and that's our next class. We're going to talk about, and we're going to go to a lecture at Carnegie Mellon University in Pittsburgh, from one of the guys that I think is one of the better discussers of leadership ethics. And we're going to talk about ethics, and we're going to see it from the point of view of not only his point of view. I'm just looking at the time. I don't have time for this video. We may wrap class just a few minutes early. We're going to look at the United States Navy. How do they teach ethics? And it's interesting, they don't call it ethics in the United States Navy. They call it leadership. It's an expectation. This is how you run a battleship. There are boundaries that you are not expected ever to cross. And they teach some of that at something they call 77 Gettysburg. And they send people from the Naval Academy every summer to Gettysburg, the battlefield where more U.S. soldiers died than any other battlefield in the world ever. Gettysburg. If you study the Civil War, you know the back and forth of that battle. The generals and the moves that they made and the mistakes that they made. We in retrospect can look at that. And the United States Navy sends leaders there every summer to walk the battlefield, to talk about the leadership decisions that were made and the ethics of shooting at your neighbor, which is part of what happened at Gettysburg. More people died in Gettysburg from their wounds than from fatal injury. They got infected, they died, they bled out on the battlefield, and the both armies had ethics violations there in terms of, you know, the Marine Corps says we bring everybody home. Well, the Civil War area, we hadn't agreed on that yet. And so people were left to die and bleed out because it was risky for me to drag them out. But that was my team, my guy that's laying there. So the Navy uses that as a training ground. And so we're going to look at that a little bit and what they're teaching and how they teach it. And then we're going to introduce some topics about ethics that are important for us in human resources. They're critical for the company as the ethical position of the company. Some of these papers that you read about these famous companies that we know, they've talked about ethics there. They talked about what's right and wrong for the company. That's their values, what's right and wrong. We're gonna look at ethics for our businesses. We're going to look at it broadly, and then we're going to look at it for our business as well on Tuesday then. So that will be our agreement to do that. Welcome to the class, those of you that are here for the first time, the first night. I love the fact that you're here and you're part of the team. And those of you that are seniors have been here longer in the program, welcome back. I'm glad that you all are here as well. We still may have a couple more people that will join us. And if you know somebody that ought to take this class, please let them know and let me know. We would like to invite more. We have some empty chairs still. We can fit a couple more people in the room. If you know, let me know. I'll let Maddie know. However, get the word to us, and we'll invite others to join us as well. I think this is going to be a good way to spend Tuesday and Thursday evenings in our summer here in St. George. Air conditioning is good, I'm looking forward to getting to know each of you a little bit better and what you have to contribute, and I'm excited for us to learn together about this topic of talent development. The last thing before we dismiss, the word development. What all does development mean to you? Let's
create or build.
To build? Together. Okay. To develop, what does it strike you? Ground rule in this class, I told you I'd add some as I remember them. One thing is, it's a legal ground rule to pass. Anytime I happen to call on you, if you're not ready with an answer or you don't care to share at that moment in time, or if I ask you to read something and you just took a big bite of a brownie, that passing is fine. So we'll give you a pass right now on that. Somebody else helping. What is to develop? What is? Say that again.
Process of growing, to grow.
Okay. So one of the pieces of develop is growing. What do we have to do before we can do that?
Recognize
or what?
The potential.
What is the potential? Maybe a developer is looking at a freeway exit on, you know, let's go Washington Parkway exit 8. Is that exit 8? That's 10, maybe exit 10. Washington Parkway. It's got Maverick at one side and a whole bunch of empty ground that way. And a bunch of people have said they're going to do something over there that way. But a developer at some time will grasp that potential and will develop that land. And to develop it, they're going to tear it up first. They'll smooth it out. They'll pull the boulders and rocks out of it probably. Put some infrastructure in place. Put curb and sewer and water and those power in there. And then they will grow something. They'll build something that fits their vision of the potential that was there. And we've heard a hospital wanting to develop part of that at one point in time. We've heard a guy that crossed the freeway was going to build an outdoor theater, and maybe he's going to take it over that way up against the rocks instead. So these are visions that people have about what something can be. Well, isn't that really what I want for me? I want somebody to have a vision about what I could be, you know, that knows me and sees my blind sides, sees what I do bring, and helps me keep that in check and balance so that I'm aware of my blind sides, my shortcomings, my weaknesses, as you might call them, and says, I see a bunch of potential. We got some rocks we got to pull out of there. and we got some stuff that we need to do, but there's some potential here. And I and maybe with somebody you look and you say, this person has a lot of potential. And we want them on our team and in our group, but and so we're gonna invest. That exit's not gonna make any money for a long time if somebody starts developing it, right? It's gonna lose money. You're gonna have to pump dollars into that area before it's gonna start returning them. And so that's kind of the same with talent development, same thing. We put effort into taking somebody and helping them bloom, helping their talents get polished and come out or have an opportunity to exercise them. We don't get it right the first time, they do anything. You don't brush your teeth right the first time. You figure out which end of the thing to hold. And then from there you learn, right? And that's how we get development, and talent development is that. So first for us, recognizing what talent we have, that's something that some of us haven't done yet. We don't even know what talent we have yet. And so that'll be a discovery process. Then figuring out what is the talent that really could be developed. What can you be world-class at? We've had that. Jim Collins in our previous reading that we were reading was talking about exactly that with the hedgehog concept. For those that you read Jim Collins talking about what can you be best in the world at. That is, and now let's develop that. Let's spend time and effort because you're world-class potentially in that. And so that talent development for us, and then we want to do that as an organization to the new kids that are on our team. So every time we hire somebody new, we want to engage them in a way where we assess what they have to offer. We help them discover what they have to offer. We help them develop that. You know, everybody can't rope. But if somebody's got the talent, the raw talent to do that, I say that one because that's probably one of the farthest skills for me. I don't even know. That's magic. I don't even know how anybody does it, much less in the time that they do it in. It's like, what? How did you do that? And I watch it in slow motion. I still don't get it. It's like, wow, how do you get all that stuff to work like that? And that's the way it is with every skill, isn't it? The professionals do it in such a way it looks effortless. But it's only because somebody developed the talent. Somebody invested and helped groom and grow. And that's what this class is really about. We have a team, we have an HR team that's assigned to do that, but honestly, that's something that happens with every supervisor, every manager, and every owner of every business has got to be dialed into that. So with that, we're done. We're gonna have a great weekend, I hope. Be safe, we'll see you at 5:30 on Tuesday. Thanks much. Andrew, thank you for reminding me to start the video.
You're welcome.